can't see the on button.
How's everybody today?
Good.
My name is Greg Pringle with the ODOT Civil Rights Division, and I'm here to introduce David A. Bates, the Area Director of the Oklahoma City Office, Area Office of OSHA, Occupational Safety and Health Administration.
Very good.
Mr. Bates began his career with OSHA in Little Rock, Arkansas, office in 1983 as a student co-op. He worked as a compliance officer at the Dallas and Fort Worth offices from 1985 to 1993. He has worked for OSHA as an assistant area director in Bridgeport, Connecticut, and Little Rock, Arkansas area offices from 1993 until 2008, and is now area director of the Oklahoma area office. David has a Bachelor of Science degree in Industrial Technology from the University of Central Arkansas and for basketball fans, and he had one class with Scotty Pippen. Without further ado, please welcome David Bates.
Thank you very much. Thanks. Yeah, it's as the young folks say, who's he? Yeah. So, you know who he is. Okay, Megan. Well, thank you. I want to thank ODOT, first of all, for putting this together. Whenever Victoria sent me something about having a seminar with some of the smaller employers that are ODOT's contractors, I was very interested because, you know, when we make our inspections, a lot of times we're on the large projects, and we'll talk a little bit today about what all we do. You know, road and bridge construction is not all that we do, although we do some of that, but we do building construction. We inspect oil and gas production, servicing, and drilling operations out there, which keeps us busy. We inspect manufacturing plants, refineries. So we have to do a lot of different things, but whenever, you know, a lot of times we're dealing with the larger employers on these inspections, so if we can come and do some proactive ahead of the game and with smaller employers that are trying to do the right thing, that's what we're interested in. So I was eager to help out with this. You got it working?
Yes.
Okay, good. Very good. So for those of you that have never dealt with OSHA before, this is our area office. This is the area office that covers the state of Oklahoma. We go all over the state making inspections, and we help employers all over the state as well through cooperative programs. So, and we'll talk a little bit about those today too. But if you ever need, even though a lot of companies say never call OSHA, you can call us. You don't have to tell us where you are, who you are, or where you're working at. You can call. We always have a duty officer that's answering questions and can assist you with things. So please give us a call. That's our number. How many have been to our website before? We're going to refer to it quite a bit today because there's a lot of good information on there. But that's our website that will you can go on there and find regulations, interpretations, training materials. And then the last thing is if you ever need OSHA after hours, you can call that number and it's answered all the time. And then they in turn have all of our cell phone numbers at our house, so if they have to call us after hours. So why anybody know why companies might have to call that after hours? What's one of the requirements that companies have that you have to report in a certain number of hours?
Fatalities.
Yeah. So if you have, hopefully you never have to do that, but if you have a fatality to report and you want to meet the 8-hour requirement, you can call that number at any time and then they get a hold of us on reporting that. A little bit about our staff. Some of them are here today. I'm going to introduce them, but Stephen Kirby and Megan Christie are here today. They're the two assistant area directors and they're going to give part of the presentation today. And we have 18 compliance officers. Stacy McAndrews is one of them that covers the whole state. And she's actually been out on a couple of road and bridge incidents here recently. In fact, yesterday she was out on one that occurred. So she may talk a little bit about those today. I don't know. We may tell you a little bit about what happened with those, because what we've prepared today for you is kind of focused on what we're finding out there and the accidents that are occurring, because we can learn from those and hopefully you can prevent We want to try to prevent and drive those injuries, illnesses, and fatalities down in the state. So there's 18 compliance officers. Those 18 work, half of them work for Megan, half of them work for Steven. So you kind of know how our office works. So that's on the enforcement side. So all the inspections, the enforcement activity that we do in the state, and we conduct about 750 to 800 inspections a year in Oklahoma. And that's all those different industries that I told you about. So, and about 60% of that is in the construction industry. So we also have some outreach people. And Jorge DeLuca is our compliance assistant specialist. So if you need an OSHA flavor to one of your safety meetings, or you need some assistance on putting together some training for your staff, he can help. He's a non-enforcement person. So he can come out, give speeches, do outreach, do some research for you if you need something. And then we have a program called the Voluntary Protection Program in the state. And there's about 45 companies in Oklahoma that belong to the VPP program. And these are companies that have elite safety and health programs, and they want to get recognition for that. And they will apply and do an application, and then we do an audit to see if they pass. And if they do, they're accepted into that program, and they get to fly a VPP star flag. Anybody ever seen a VPP star flag? No? If you drive by the Xerox plant, it's got one flying. What other local ones do we have? Cameron Valve down in the south part of the city has a flag flying. So if you ever see a VPP star flag, they're in this program. There's only about 45 of them in Oklahoma. We have a coordinator, Janet Barker, who does those audits. So that's another cooperative program that we do. Then we have a discrimination investigator. This is our whistleblower investigator. So I don't know if it would surprise you or not on how many employees get terminated, adverse action taken against them for participating in OSHA activity, filing complaints. So if an employee files a complaint and adverse action is taken afterwards, they're considered a whistleblower and they have rights under the OSHA Act. And so Renell Newport investigates those in Oklahoma. In addition to the section in the OSHA Act that protects whistleblowers, there are 19 other statutes that they've given to our whistleblower group. So we do whistleblower activity for other federal agencies. So DOT is one of them. So if a contractor or a trucking company is cooking the books, you know, making their drivers drive longer and annotate it wrong, there's actually a DOT regulation against that. And if a truck driver gets fired for that, she investigates it. She also has some Federal Aviation Administration whistleblower, consumer product safety, the Sarbanes-Oxley Act under the Security Exchange Commission she covers. So there's 19 other statutes besides OSHA that they do as well. So that's kind of our staff in Oklahoma. We're located downtown. So do what?
Where there's no parking,
that's right. we're trying to move. So anyway, I kind of want to introduce who's going to be here today. We're going to kind of change it up, and each person has. But if you have your agenda here, what we've put together for you is kind of we wanted to focus on what we're finding out there. So maybe what we'd like to do is when you leave here, we'd like you to have the tools to go out and be in compliance. So if you ever get a visit from us, you'll be in good shape. That's our goal. So Megan's going to talk about some of the leading hazards that we find in the construction industry, and some of it's, I guess, focused on road and bridge. Then I'm going to talk a little bit about how many have a written safety program in your company. Anybody? And you don't, you know, it's okay. I mean, it doesn't have to be written. But I'm going to talk about your safety program, how to develop, what it should include, and how to audit it. So hopefully that'll give you a tool to go out and improve your job sites. Steven's going to talk about something that's very important, and that's the training of your employees and how to do that. And also, you might be surprised at how many different construction standards require training. So he's going to go through all those for you today. And then we'll do a record keeping at the end. And Stacy has been responsible for doing we've had a national emphasis program up until, was it last year that we had an adverse court decision come out? And I don't know, she may talk about the Volks decision today. I don't want to steal her thunder, but we used to have an emphasis program where we would go into a facility and actually do a record keeping audit. It's a focus on your injury and illness records. And so she has a lot of expertise in that, and she's going to tell you what your requirements are to keep the OSHA 300 logs and all your injury and illness records and how it can help your safety program. So that's what we've put together for you today. Any general questions before we get to the specifics? No? Well, Megan is up first. She's going to talk about some of the leading causes of or leading hazards that we find out there. So.
And I'm going to talk about the leading hazards that we see in the construction industry and in general industry, actually. I'm going to focus on what we call the focus four hazards. So if you have a question while I'm talking or, you know, something isn't clear, please feel free to, you know, just speak up. I want this to be kind of an open communication between us, and we will try to answer your questions as best that we can. Okay, so what are the focus four hazards, as they're called? Those focus four hazards are electrical hazards, struck by hazards, caught in between hazards, and fall hazards. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to talk about each of these subcategories in detail. And then after that, we'll go through kind of what citations we are seeing and what things that we are finding wrong when we're doing inspections. And that way you'll understand kind of where the hazards fall into our standards and, you know, where to look in our standards for more information about each of those potential citations that we're seeing in the field. Okay, so the first focused hazard that I'm going to talk about is electrocution fatalities. Basically, what we're seeing in general is that people are coming in contact with overhead power lines, with machinery or other equipment that they're using on the job site. In maybe some other types of industries, they're contacting circuit panels that are live. Tools or power cords or power equipment are not being maintained, and therefore people are contacting live circuits that way. And then another electrical issue or an electrocution issue is lightning strikes. So when you're out in the work zone, you know, you may be out in an open area and you may be vulnerable to something like that. Okay, so we'll talk more about each of these categories. I'm just going to do kind of a intro for each of the types of hazards, and then we'll go into detail. Then the second item we'll talk about is struck by issues. And normally what we're seeing with struck by hazards are you know, failure of rigging equipment in construction industry. Shifting materials, maybe a trailer load of materials falling off of a trailer and striking someone. Equipment tipping over or malfunctioning. No overhead protection, meaning something is falling off of a lower level. And then vehicles and equipment striking someone. Okay, and then the third of the focus four is our caught in between hazards. And we see those often in trenching and excavation with rotating equipment, unguarded parts, the swing radius of a crane catching someone or some other equipment, and then equipment rollovers as well. And then the fourth of our focus four is falls. And falls, you know, can happen in, you know, many different ways, but usually an unprotected side, edge or a ledge, a hole, an improperly guarded fall hazard off of a railing, or if you're working on a bridge, maybe someone falls from an unguarded side while they're working on a bridge project, or even slips, trips, and you know, poor housekeeping, keeping a cluttered work area, things like that can cause fall hazards. Okay, so now I'm going to go kind of into detail on the electrical issues that we're seeing. So if you have any questions, please feel free to ask me. I will try to focus on what's more important for construction projects that you guys would be working on. But there are some items in here that may not be as applicable, but I didn't want to take them out because I did want you to have some of an awareness of those items, so I did leave them in. So here's just some examples of things that we see in terms of electrical hazards on a lot of different types of job sites. You know, we'll see breakers that are, you know, missing boxes and covers that are open and face plates missing on electrical boxes and cords that are frayed and insulation that's broken. So those are kinds of things we see all the time in general industry and in construction. And then I kind of wanted to do a little bit of just kind of a general awareness of, you know, what energy levels can cause harm in the human body in terms of, you know, getting an electrical current through your body. 1 milliamp is barely, you can barely sense that. 16 milliamps, if you contacted like 16 milliamps, you could let go of that current. That's something that a human could let go of. Once you pass that threshold, you can cause serious damage to internal organs, and you may actually, if you're actually holding it, you may not be able to let go. You'll hold on because your muscles won't be able to open up. And so the average home has 15, 20 amp breakers. So that puts it in perspective that you have this potential even in your own homes. So this is, you know, something you can take home with you or use on your job sites for an awareness. We require that GFIs are used on job sites. And I just wanted to talk a little bit about how those work. GFIs are ground fault circuit interrupters. And basically what they do is they monitor the flow of current from hot to neutral, and they sense a change in that. So when the levels are not the same, when flow is not the same, they will trip and basically stop the flow of energy. So they'll trip between 4 and 6 milliamps of a difference within 1/140th of a second. So that's something that you don't even know it's happening. So I just wanted to make sure you understand those and how those should be used in your job. They should be used all the time in construction, and they don't have to be at the point of, you know, when you plug something in, they can be back at the source, so it just has to be on that circuit at some point. Okay.
Can I say something?
Yeah.
Well, where's the best place to plug your GFCI in if you're going to use GFCI? Anybody? Back at the source, because it covers your cords. If you're going to use extension cords, if you plug it in at the end of your extension cords are not covered.
Right.
So it's best to plug it in closest to the source, so everything from that point out to your tools. I'm going to use generators. Yeah. So do you have to have them on generators? Yeah. 5 kW or more, you got to use these on your portable generators. Or if you're using a generator that doesn't have an insulated, isolated circuit. Most of your new ones do have that, but you may have, if you have an old one or an old welder with some, we find some of those circuits are not isolated from the frame. It doesn't matter what the wattage.
Okay. Yeah, no, please add.
It's best to use a portable generator.
Yeah.
Get your portable one.
Yeah,
of course. Your generator and plug them in right there before you plug your cord.
Yeah. And kind of on the same lines, a lot of things we see this often is we'll find a cord with the ground pin cut off. So make sure that, you know, when you're doing part of your inspection program, that you're looking at your cords and making sure that they're not missing a ground pin, because where they were plugging it in didn't have a place to plug the ground in, so we just went ahead and clipped that off because we needed to plug it in there. So we do see that quite a lot in construction and in general industry. We see it in both. So that kind of leads into how do you make sure your equipment is grounded and your equipment is safe that's being used? And so inspection is how you can make sure that your equipment is being maintained. And so what is recommended is that electrical equipment is maintained before each use, but it should be inspected and documented every quarter at a minimum. And most of the time we see a color coding system applied. So the spring will have a 3-month period of color. And so once you've done your inspection, you'll change it to the next color. So then you'll know when you need to inspect the equipment again. And you need to document that inspection has taken place and take out of service anything that doesn't meet the requirements. And then repair anything that might need repair at that point. And some people will go as far as to do a monthly inspection, but that's up to you and what you think you need to do.
Maybe. Mm-hmm. As far as documentation, if you come in for an audit, whatever you want to call it, is that sufficient?
Like
the quarterly method, color coding?
Yeah, if you've got, if you have the tape on your cord and you have documentation that, this extension cord or, this tool.
I'm not talking about an extra piece of paper. I'm talking about literally if I have blue tape that means spring or winter on my cord and I know my system is, mm-hmm. I can show you where my system is, that's sufficient.
Didn't that standard require a written program?
If you have a written program along with it,
I think that would be a case of your written program should, at the very minimum, who's responsible for the inspections, who did the last inspection, and then what the color coding should
have. Okay.
Right. Wouldn't.
So, this is an either-or regulation. So you can either have GFCIs, or you can run this program.
Do the conductivity,
GFCIs. So you don't have GFCIs, you can run this program. This program is a little bit...
it's time intensive.
Burdensome to keep up with.
Because you have a lot of cords.
A lot of record keeping.
And it's really easy to miss one or a cord show up that's where'd this come from, and it's on the job site and all of a sudden you're not in compliance with it.
But I've been on job sites where GCs make you do both.
Yeah.
I have Flint code.
They're
one of them.
Which, is an extra.
It's just more, more to remember to do.
Keeps an eye on those. And we're at GFCIs when we're out there, and you'd be surprised how many times they're not working. For what some GCs are saying, if you have a bad GFCI, we got this covered. Protected employees now, so you may run across
that. Have a backup.
And general contractors can require above and beyond. Our standards are minimal. They're of a minimal safety protection, so you'll get some contractors that will go above and beyond what we have. So.
Okay. Now I'm going to talk a little bit about kind of what we're seeing in terms of the electrical issues on site. We see a lot of electrical cords that are, insulation's been cut. Maybe there's some exposed conductors, which could, if someone were to, contact that line, could pose them an electrocution hazard. So, running over cords or allowing equipment to drive over them repeatedly without protecting them is how we're seeing these types of things happen. And then just general wear and tear on equipment on a construction site, your cords are going to probably get damaged. So, it's always a good idea to inspect them anyway and make sure that they're in good condition. So you'll know when to take things out of compliance and make sure your people understand when they need to say, hey, this is not in good shape. I need to get rid of this. We need to dispose of this and get a new one. So that's, a very important thing to train on. Okay, wiring, this may not be something that you're going to see in your industry, but, any electrical wire needs to be in a closed box or panel and not exposed where people could incidentally contact live wires or loose wiring or exposed conductors. So, just general rule of thumb, electrical wiring needs to be enclosed. Electrical panels, they need to have the original door front on them so that people couldn't incidentally contact them with equipment if they're in the work area or hands. Make sure the perimeter is marked off. You want to park equipment right in front of a panel just so it has access. And don't use any paper or cardboard inside a panel box. That's probably not something that is particularly important for your industry, but I wanted to make sure and include it. I didn't want to take it out because most of you do have actual offices as well, so it's just kind of a general rule of thumb. And kind of along those same lines, just wanted to breeze over a little bit about what an electric arc is, and talk about arc flash. It's not something that you're probably going to have to deal with a lot in your types of industry, but I think I read last night there's 10 arc flash incidents every day in the U.S. So it is something that's happening a lot, and it does cause a lot of harm and death to employees. So it's basically what it is it's extreme radiant heat that will basically, I'll show you this picture. It kind of gives you a better image. That's not my picture. Okay. Well, that is an aftermath. That is not my picture, so I don't know where that came from. But basically, that's the aftermath of an arc flash coming out of an electric panel. And the amount of force that comes out of a panel, heat and force and radiant light, is enough to basically burn, I don't know what the temperature is, I think it's 35,000 degrees Fahrenheit. So the potential for serious physical harm from an arc flash is extremely high. And these pictures can illustrate, you know, the damage that can occur from an arc flash. And that's a person's clothing after an arc flash. And this is a person that experienced an arc flash, and you can see what parts were covered on the person. And they're basically melted. So, yeah. It was in the program, yeah. Yeah. So, and this kind of illustrates what happens during an arc flash, and you know, all of the different types of energy that can come out of an electrical current appliance, breaker box or panel where this arc flash is coming from. You're going to have molten metal at 1800 degrees. You're going to have pressure coming out. So there's all kinds of forces coming at an employee potentially, or anyone in the area, and shrapnel from, you know, the breaker itself or the box and panel itself. And so this is just something I want you to be aware of in general. I didn't want to take this out because it's something that we're seeing 10 times a day in the U.S. on the average. So I wanted to leave this in. And the requirements for arc flash protection are all evolved from our National Fire Protection Association 70E, and that will establish our boundaries for protecting employees and how, what kind of PPE they should wear when doing each type of job, and understanding the tools that they can use, and what kind of training is required for someone who is potentially exposed to an arc flash hazard. Okay. Best way to not contact electrical energy is to shut equipment down before you work on it, and then establish an electrically safe working condition and have an electrical safety program in place so that employees are trained and aware of issues they may have if they need to work on something that is energized or may become energized. Now, for your industry, heavy construction, oftentimes what we see is equipment contacting overhead power lines. And so we're going to talk a little bit about some of the things that we have seen and some of the guidelines for that types of work. This is a picture of it. I think this is where the truck was parked. But I'll show you that's the truck. This dump truck contacted overhead power lines, and the current went through this truck, and actually the heat of the electricity and energy blew the tires off of each side, and that one of the tires blew 60 feet off the truck. So in addition to this electrical hazard of contacting a overhead power line, they also had an additional hazard of struck by when this tire blew off the truck. So all of these things, you know, they add up, and so you may have one hazard and it could lead to another one. So I just wanted to share that instance with you because we do see this more than we should. We do see heavy equipment contacting overhead power lines very often. And this is another case where someone was working in a, I know it's kind of hard to see, but this is it's a little bright in here. That's a bucket on like an aerial lift that contacted an overhead power line, and there's a person in there. So they contacted a live line, and this person was electrocuted because most aerial equipment is not insulated. So this person wasn't protected at all. So it does happen. We have several instances in the past year of this happening in construction and in general industry. So just here's some just general facts about power lines. Most overhead lines are not insulated. There any covering on them is just merely for weather protection. If you stay on the ground, you should be safe. If you maintain your appropriate distance from these lines, you should be fine. And what we've seen is that most of the time, it's the ground people working that are killed by these overhead power lines. So if they go down, they're energizing the ground around the people, and they're becoming energized that way. So that's something to think about. Maintaining your safe distances. Now, these are a minimum. Our requirements are a minimum. So basically, the minimum distance that all equipment must be maintained from overhead power lines is 10 feet. And that's from 50 kilovolts or less. So anytime the power overhead lines are greater than 50 kilovolts, then you have to add 0.4 inches, roughly a half an inch, for every 50 kilovolts. And this is a minimum. So, you know, typically what is recommended is if it's a 100 kV line, keep 15 feet of distance from those. If it's a 350 kilovolt line, keep 20 feet, and so forth. So, and that's a minimum. You can always require a greater distance of your equipment from those lines. You can also ask the power company to come. If you're in a very small area, come and cover the lines for you so that you're not, you know, if incidental contact does happen, that your employees are protected. So,
Anybody ever requested the power company come up and cover? Anybody? Yeah. Did they do it? Mm-hmm. Yeah. I've run across some power companies that won't do it because they've had problems with now the employees think, what?
Yeah.
All you have to have is a pin, a little break or a pinhole in those, and some of the bolts can travel through it.
Yeah.
Employees get this false sense of security. Now they can go right up and touch that sleeve or that blanket. So some of the power companies, I think OG&E does.
Yeah.
They will sleeve it.
I've been out
there. But I've dealt with some that won't do it. So they tell you to keep.
That's just like your second. That's like your backup plan. Make sure your distances are enforced and people don't rely on those sleeves as their only form of protection. So, but that is something that you could do if you were going to be in a really tight area and you wanted to double your protection. You could try and ask that.
The training, I mean, you know, having that knowledge is important. I remember maybe 14, 15 years ago, I worked in the car business, and we had a guy doing the banners on the poles, and he had a new guy that was working with him, and he had him in the bucket,
mm-hmm.
and I mean, all you saw was contact, and you saw sparks go everywhere, because instead of him staying and working underneath, he tried to maneuver where he could go over the top, and he made contact with the line,
mm-hmm.
and it just...
Yep.
What was his injury?
He had some, I forgot what degree burns he had, I mean, the truck, it was gone.
Mm-hmm.
You saw a spark go down, you know, travel all the way from the bucket down the arm, you know, to the truck, and he was working the bucket off of a generator, and I mean, it blew.
The whole.
Yeah, this voltage is unforgiving.
Yeah.
I've seen
very few
power lines before, and it just melted everything.
Yeah.
Melted the tires, the cab, and everything.
I will say, it seems like most of the times that we've done inspections in the last few years, that the person that contacted had absolutely no idea. It appeared as though the person that contacted had absolutely no idea it was even in the general vicinity. It wasn't as if they had talked about, you know, maintaining a distance. It was like, they lifted something up and they contacted. They didn't even think about it. So that's, you know, kind of where training comes into play and you know, doing your audits and making sure people are actually doing, keeping and maintaining that distance.
So that's the same thing you said, Amy, about the dump trucks. It was out in four corners and they were dumping. And I don't know why it seems like the dump truck drivers, they always want to drive a distance when they're up in the
Yeah,
air,
like shake know? It out, yeah. Yeah, and that's why it's a 10 feet from anywhere, 10 foot minimum distance from anywhere. So if you have, you know, a boom, that can make it a lot more difficult to maintain that 10 feet. So
well, the roll up covers, we investigated a construction fatality where he was rolling up the cover and contacted the fire line. He was directly under it.
Yeah, and see, here's like a forklift lifting up materials to the top of this roof. So when anytime you got an articulating boom, it makes it even a more challenge to maintain that 10 foot at any point. So you've always got to be aware of anything like this out on the job site. Yeah. Okay, this is just another instance of, this is like, looks like an employee working a pretty tight clearance of power lines. You know, if you need to use a spotter, if someone's, you know, going to be within close to that 10-foot minimum, you know, you can use a spotter to try and help make sure that they're, you know, they stop or they understand how close they are. Because they may have limited sight as to what they're doing. They're going to need someone to help them, guide them into the place that they need to work. Okay.
Is there a question?
Yeah.
On the previous slide, it said that you must have
I think we're lucky here that OG&E will do it.
No.
I don't think they have to.
So if you could not get them to do that, you would have to stop them?
Well, you would have to maintain your distances or figure out. Now, they've come out and moved the lines before.
Yeah, they'll jump them.
If they just leave them, then you request them to move them.
Yeah.
Or be interdependent.
Because they may not want to cut service to somebody, but they
can't. We had a billboard incident where they didn't want to sleeve them.
They appreciate it if you do the call them, because otherwise if something happens and out of power, they're going to come out anyway.
Mm-hmm.
Work. So at least give them a call. They're more likely will come out and try to do some work with you.
Okay. Okay, so if equipment does contact an overhead line, there is a potential and high likelihood that that energy might dissipate down into the ground around the equipment. And so this is another way that employees can contact an electric current. So, you know, if you step across two different potentials when you're trying to exit equipment, you need to maintain, you know, an awareness of that, because people have, I think a previous slide, it said that most of our fatalities are from the ground person. So that's just something to think about and encourage in training, you know, making sure that you're assessing if you find yourself in a position like this, you know, you need to assess the situation before you, you know, leave the equipment, because you may be safe in the equipment until you step outside. So it's just something to consider. Yeah. If you do contact line and, you know, and you're in some equipment and you're able to warn others, and you know you're going to want to contact the power company immediately, and try to move away if you can, move the equipment out of the hazard. Okay, this is kind of going over that the bailout procedures. Hopefully we don't have to do this. Unfortunately, we have investigated plenty of times when people have had to bail out of equipment. Generally, you want to keep your feet together so you're not contacting two different currents, and don't touch the machine and shuffle so that you're maintaining that contact, so you're not going to be at two different levels of charge and potentially get current through your body. So hopefully this isn't something that we'll have to worry about, but in the event, stay in the equipment, right? Get that power off and then get out of your equipment. Yeah. Okay, that was kind of long. I think the next few will go by a little bit quicker. The second of our focus four is struck by hazards. Most commonly, we're seeing struck by hazards in rollover incidents of crane or heavy equipment, dump trucks, something being struck by a boom of a crane. I think some of the statistics are that 20% of crane fatalities are from struck bys from crane tip overs, and we do see that quite a bit. It seemed like a period of time where we had them back to back here in the Oklahoma City area, where it seemed like every other day we were getting a call about something like that. Luckily, that seemed to slow down, so that's always a good thing. Then there's lots of issues with handling of loads, things falling off of forklifts, rigging equipment that's not appropriate or not of the right strength or improperly rigged, where materials are falling and striking people below, and maybe an employee that doesn't know how to rig a certain lift appropriately. So that's where we're seeing struck by fatalities most often, if it's involving a crane, because materials are falling from great heights. A good way to prevent struck by injuries from cranes is to make sure that your rigging equipment is maintained properly. So doing a sling inspection before each lift. How many do sling inspections on their job sites? Yeah? Okay. That's kind of your first line of defense. Make sure your equipment's in good shape. And then second to that is make sure your employees know how to actually use the equipment, know what the capacities of each type of lift that they're doing are, and configuration of their slings, make sure that they understand how they can use slings in certain lifts. And then another thing, it's not on here, but wire rope, making sure wire rope is in good condition if you are using wire rope. Slings for any reason, doing inspections on your wire ropes every day or every shift to make sure that they're in good condition. We do see instances of wire ropes that have probably exceeded their lifetime by several months that are still being used a lot. So if in doubt, take it out of service and get something new. Okay. And that's just an illustration of a sling tag, and it's showing you the different configurations right here and the capacities of those configurations. So you'll be able to make sure that your employees know how to look at those. And a lot of times that you won't be able to see that after about the fifth time it's been used, because it'll be so dirty. So that's where training comes into play. So the employee will recognize that sling and understand what the capacity of that sling could be in those instances. Here's another instance of a struck by. That's a rather large piece of equipment taking out a rather large truck. So that just illustrates, yeah, that's never gonna be good. Hopefully no one was in that truck when that happened. Here's more along the lines of probably what you guys as contractors are doing in road work. A lot of times you're gonna have people walking around on the road and large trucks coming down the same road. You know, this picture shows, it's kind of hard to see and I apologize for that, but shadows where a person could be standing in the shadow of that truck and you may not even see them. So awareness of these types of things on your job site are really important, and any of the drivers that may come onto your site, making sure that they understand that as well.
And that's what David was talking about earlier, is in the last 2 months we've had three highway incidents of running over, backing over their own employees.
Mm-hmm. Well, and go ahead.
It's just, it's really critical. One of the things is spotters. They're not being used. I mean, the guys can't see what's behind them. The mirrors aren't adjusted properly if they have them. Just awareness on who's where. And you said there was some safe distances or something, right?
Yeah. I forgot to send this to you, Victoria, but I've got another PowerPoint today. I don't know if I have time to show up, but I'll try and I'll get it to her so she can get out to you. But I found Navy, of all organizations, has a safe distance for people around each type of equipment. And it goes from school buses to loaders to backhoes to dump trucks. And it depends on the type of equipment, on because some of these, you'll have a blind spot, you know, these cranes that have a little cab in them and you can't see to this, so your approach distance for people on foot go way out next to it. So I'll send that to Victoria and give it to you. But this is what's happening. I'm going to profile the fatalities over the last 5 years in your industry, and this is what's happening most of the time. We've got a few other things, but people are getting involved.
To add to that, and David will probably cover it, but the three instances that Stacy mentioned were all slow-moving vehicles. There was an asphalt milling machine, a side load, what was it, that track, you know, where they're laying pipeline? A side boom loader, and a track hoe excavator setting the concrete partition.
Yeah,
so they're all crawling along at 1 and 2 miles an hour, and that's who's getting run over. and so that, you know, you think, oh, it's the dump truck or the highway traffic, you know, down the highway at 30, 40, 50 miles an hour, and our last three incidents were.
Right.
Yeah.
We do get those, but.
Yeah, we did some, but yeah.
Here's another picture of an employee right between another piece of equipment and a dump truck, and that's definitely the driver of that truck cannot see that person. So that's, you know, that's a training issue, that's an awareness issue on part of the employee, and you know, maybe that is the spotter. You know, that's another thing to think about, is making sure that spotters know what all their job entails and that they can't put themselves in a dangerous position as well. So there's another picture, someone's working underneath the raised part of a dump truck. So who knows that if that power goes and that bed falls down, that it's not going to end well. So training on when to not do certain things, and yeah.
You can do that work. What has to be done there?
Yeah.
Cribbing, blocking, supporting that before you get under there.
Yeah. Got to make sure all the sources of potential energy are maintained in a safe. Yep. Isolate those potentials, and that does not appear to be done in this instance. Okay. Equipment rollover. It does happen. It happens quite a bit. It looks like these instances, it looks like a couple times pieces of equipment. One of them looks like a crane. This one looks like a crane just tipped into a trench. So, you know, if you have employees working in these trenches, then, you know, they're exposed to potentially being crushed as a result of equipment falling in. So, you know, training and making sure employees understand how close they can actually get to these types of things so that they don't put themselves in the position to act potentially fall into or roll their equipment over. And then in equipment, wearing your seatbelt, we have a lot of instances where employees are thrown from equipment or fall from equipment when the equipment rolls, and had they been wearing a seatbelt, they'd still be in the equipment and they probably would have been injured, but they wouldn't have been crushed by the equipment. So if there is a seatbelt to be worn, wear it. Don't ride on buckets or forks of forklifts, which we see all the time. In the back of a pickup truck is not the right way to do it. So, you know, being aware of where employees can be transported and where they should ride. Backing equipment. Anything that's backing up should have an audible beeping sound to it so that people in the area know that equipment is about to back up. Having a spotter help to guide the driver when they're backing, and keeping adequate distance of other things, and just generally paying attention to what is going on in the work area. Making sure your equipment that has backup alarms actually work, because I know we've had some instances where People have been struck by equipment, and we're not sure if the backup alarm was working at that time or not. So just, you know, check your equipment, make sure that it does work. High visibility vest helps make sure that people can see workers, not only in, you know, dusk or darkness, but just during the day in general. It's a good practice to make sure that your employees are wearing these. They have to for road work and trenching and excavation and most construction. So it's a good practice, and it does just help add another level of awareness and prevention to this, any kind of a struck by incident with heavy equipment involved, particularly. Then, you know, when employees are loading, or anytime there's loading activities on site, that's another chance for a possible struck by hazard. If equipment is not used properly to load, if things are not tied down properly, we have had several instances of materials being delivered to job sites, piping and things like that, falling and striking employees that are just in the general area, not even trying to unload the equipment. So, you know, being aware of what's being delivered onto your site. If you're having any pipe or anything, you're laying piping delivered and someone's going to be taking it off, make sure that employees know, unless you're specifically trained to do this, that you need to stay back and make sure that the equipment is being taken, unloaded properly, and that there's no potential struck by hazards associated with equipment being delivered to your site. Maintenance activities, probably not something that you guys are going to be worrying about on a day-to-day basis, but there are instances where there might be some struck by hazards associated with, you know, general equipment. If you've got to change a flat tire or something on the job site, just be aware of how you can support the equipment properly so that you're not exposed to a struck by hazard. And then this is another instance of slings. This sling, I guess, in this instance right here was removed just prior to making a helicopter pick. So that, if they would have used that sling, there is a potential that it could have failed, and it looks like it's in pretty bad condition. So it looks like this sling was by the manufacturer. I can't remember who it was that used the phrase, if you see red, you're dead, which means you're seeing this red thread through here, so that when you saw that, it's time to discard that sling. And I can't remember who made that, but that's the phrase they used. And so it's a good thing they took that out of service, because it may not have gotten them through the lift that they were trying to do. This is kind of similar to what I was talking about before with the, you know, delivery of equipment and materials on site, making sure that things that are being stored for use later are stored properly and secured, so that people aren't exposed to a hazard while removing them or unloading them. Here's just another picture of piping on the job site. Looks like some of the piping has rolled off of the trailer bed, and we have, I think in the last 2 months, had two instances of fatalities with something just similar to this. And so it is happening. Those piping tubes look like they're banded together in, looks like, threes. So someone unbanded something and was in the way when it fell. So we are seeing this happening twice in the last 2 months. So just be aware of materials as they're coming onto site. Mm-hmm. Yep, they are. And I think we'll probably get into that in David's a little more on the specifics of those that we can talk about. Okay, just another thing to think of, probably not. Maybe you may have nailing guns on site, but just make sure, you know, if you're putting up any railing or building any railing, be sure that people who are using them know how to use them, because I think we've all seen news reports of people who've been struck by a nail in the head and they survived and they were lucky, but there are probably plenty of others that haven't been so lucky. And you know, even if you get it in the hand, it's not going to be a pleasant experience. So make sure your equipment safeties are working properly. Same thing with pneumatic nailers. Make sure that, you know, whoever's using them knows how to use them. And I think the only instance I can really think of for you guys is if you're building up guard railing or something like that. But just, yeah, or forms for concrete work or something. So just a general awareness. Okay, our third is our caught in between hazards. And often we're seeing these on, you know, congested work sites, highway equipment, heavy equipment, where there's maybe a lot of different trades working at once. We see a lot of this in trenching and excavation when someone is working in an open excavation and maybe they're caught by soil because they haven't been protected adequately in their excavation. And this is just a picture depicting someone. They're dropping down it looks like a large pipe, and they're using a trench box to protect their employees. This is just kind of some details about the mechanics of soil and how just a little bit of soil can weigh a lot and affect the human body and crush the human body, and just one cubic foot can cause serious injuries on top of an employee. So the further down you go, the more soil that could be potentially piled onto a person and could cause serious injury and or most likely death in the event that they're covered by soil in a trench collapse. On the job, the requirements are that someone is a competent person if there is trenching and excavation work on site. And by competent person, I think Stephen will go into this in more detail in his training session. The competent person must be able to identify and correct hazards associated with trenching and excavation. And they must be able to correct those hazards, and they must do a daily inspection on the excavation to make sure that any protective systems that are being used adequately, and employees that are working in that excavation are protected. And our general rule is that an excavation that's over 5 feet deep requires protection of some sort, whether it's benching or sloping or shielding or a trench box. And then if it's over 4 feet deep, then we require some kind of access to the excavation, whether it's a ladder or a ramp. This is a picture of a trench box. The workers need to stay inside this shielded area while they're working. And what we're seeing most often is they have one of these on site, but they didn't put it in the excavation. Or they're working outside of the box just for a minute instead of moving the box over to do the work. So this kind of a box can be used in all of the soils. There's three types of soils, A, B, and C. C is the most dangerous, I guess, loosest soil that's most likely to cause a collapse. And so this will work for even that. So we are seeing this. We have a national emphasis program for trenching and excavations in Oklahoma. So if we do see an open excavation, we can't stop and initiate an inspection on that. So we are out and about, and this is something we see very common in Oklahoma. And this is just an example of they have their trench box in the excavation, but they do not have, they're not using it properly. The box should go at least, I think it's 18 inches above the soil. So at this point, the soil could just potentially fall right into the box with the employees. So, and I don't see any access in this. So there's some issues going on with their use here. Okay, if you have an excavation on site, if it's not just blatantly obvious that it's there, it needs to be marked off and barricaded so someone couldn't incidentally walk into it. Okay. If you are going to be doing excavation work, you want to make sure you have some kind of a plan in place for rescue in the event that something did happen. A lot of fire departments are not quite sure about that, especially in rural areas. They may not have all the equipment that's needed to rescue someone from that kind of a situation. So you'll want to have thought about that beforehand and make sure that you plan. Who are we going to call? How are we going to do this? Because you may not have a whole lot of time in the event that you do need to rescue someone from a trench. So hopefully you don't, but you need to have a plan in place in the event that you do. Okay. These are just some fatalities that we've had by crushing. I know of at least one where we've had someone that's been killed, struck by, and crushed by a crane boom as they were trying to dismantle the crane and stow it to transport. So we are seeing these things happen. People are getting caught in between the swing of the crane and other equipment in the area. So we do see this happen. Yeah, and this is just another instance of the swing of rotating equipment. You need to barricade or make aware the swing radius of any of the cranes or swinging equipment you have on site so that someone couldn't just walk into that area. And if the equipment were to swing, they could be struck by that or crushed. Okay. This is just another photograph. It's kind of hard to see in this light. They have the swing radius of the cab barricaded off so that, well, it's flagged off with yellow tape so that someone couldn't just walk into it. Okay. Another thing is crushed by injuries or moving parts. This person contacted some kind of a moving part. So, you know, we were seeing amputations, potentially fatalities related to that. So in order to make sure this doesn't happen, make sure electrical equipment is off if you're going to do any kind of service to it so that it couldn't energize and start a moving part, which could catch an appendage or clothing or something like that, bleed off any energy that remains in equipment before you have someone working on it or servicing it. Guard machinery. If there's any kind of belts or pulleys being used so that someone couldn't be crushed by being pulled into a belt that's moving. Okay. Miter saws, guards need to cover the blade. We see this a lot. The guards are just gone because they're too hard to use. So make sure that when you're doing your inspections that they're still on any equipment that you might have or any equipment that any contractors bring onto your site. Okay, another grinders. I don't know if this is something that you guys will have, but grinders need to be guarded. If you're gonna have grinders on site, make sure that employees are using face shields and so that, you know, flying metal or part sparks can't get into their eyes. Dump trucks, make sure that people are maintaining safe clearances from dump trucks that are dumping materials. And you have a spotter to make sure that no one walks inadvertently into that area if a truck's going to be dumping a load. Okay, then our fourth hazard is falls. This is throwing me off. Okay, fall hazards. Okay, this shows, and these are really hard to see on the slide, but these look like these employees are doing roofing work, and it looks like they have a parapet wall and they have a warning flag, and we'll kind of talk about that a little bit more. But these employees are potentially exposed to fall hazards. This employee looks like they're doing maybe roofing work, I'm going to guess, but they have a harness and a lanyard on, and they have their anchorage system set up. It looks like that the top of the roof there so that they're tied off during their work. Yeah, trimming. Is he trimming? That's what I was thinking. It didn't look like he's doing roofing. Yeah, it's really hard to see. Okay. This is another picture. Looks like employees performing some kind of work on this roof, and they have looks like a scaffold system down below so that they can work on the scaffolding. Okay, here's our methods of fall protection that we have. We have guardrails and warning lines, then you have your safety monitor program and traditional fall arrest or fall restraint systems. This is a picture of employees working with the use of a warning line, and they have looks like a 39-inch parapet wall. They're using using their warning line and safety monitor. Does not appear to be in the picture, but there supposedly is a safety monitor here. The safety monitor's only job is to make sure that the employees do not cross that warning line and get into potential danger. And we don't see this used very well very often. I will say that for most of the times, if they're implementing this kind of a policy, the safety monitor will do something else. I think it's human nature that you can't just stand there and watch other people work, so that is their only job. They can't pick up a tool, they can't hand you equipment, they can't hand you anything else to do your work. Their job is only to watch employees so that they do not get too close to the edge. So, okay, this is just another example of a fall hazard. This is an employee working, I don't know, could be 40, 50 feet up in the air on the open side of an edge exposed to a fall hazard without any fall protection. This person is standing on the edge. Looks like they're trying to rig some kind of equipment, some kind of a material, and exposed to a fall hazard. This employee should be using some kind of fall protection to do this task. These employees are wearing traditional retractable lanyards and harnesses. And this is a pretty cluttered looking job site right here, and they may be creating some more tripping hazards with the way they have their equipment strewn across the ground. So that's something to be aware of. Okay, make sure that holes are covered or protected by railing if someone could inadvertently step on them. And the guard covers need to be sufficient enough to hold twice the intended load, so twice a person's weight is a good frame of reference. Just make sure that they're blocked so someone couldn't just accidentally walk through them. Access ways, if you have stairways or anything, I'm not sure this is something that may be too appropriate for you guys. Make sure that they're offset so someone can't just walk down and fall down into a ladder area. Make sure that there's kind of a warning for someone approaching a ladder or a stairwell. Hoisting areas, if you have a hoisting area, if you're lifting materials up to a work area, maybe on a bridge, then you'll want to make sure that those areas are guarded if they're not being used to lift materials up. And if you are lifting materials up, make sure the person that's receiving them has adequate fall protection. A lot of times there's someone up there receiving the load. Make sure that they are protected from a fall while receiving those materials. Housekeeping is another issue with fall protection. Cluttered work area can lead to trips and falls. So that can be part of, you know, general housekeeping of the work area. If you have any stairs, make sure that they're guarded. You know, maybe have temporary stairs to working areas on bridges or something. Make sure that they're appropriately guarded. Okay, scaffolding is another potential for fall hazards. Scaffolding needs to be established on firm foundations with base plates. It needs to be plumb and square and fully planked. You want to make sure that there's an appropriate egress and access for employees onto and off of scaffolding. And make sure that the scaffolding is tied into the structure if it's going to be over that 4:1 ratio of height to base of the scaffold. Here's just some instances of the foundations that scaffolding can be on. A little more about access, using a ladder to access scaffolding. Make sure they're not climbing across bracing to get onto a scaffold. And there's, it looks like a ladder frame on a scaffold, so they're crawling up right here to access. And here's a stairway onto a framed scaffold. This is probably not applicable for y'all guys, but if you are using this kind of scaffold, you want to make sure that the wheels are locked if anyone's going to be working from them. Falling object protection is something that pretty sure this should be applicable to you if you're going to have people working potentially below other employees, maybe on a bridge project. Make sure that there's falling material protection so that someone couldn't, material can't fall onto someone, using tow boards or screens to catch material.
Any bridge contractors?
Oh, okay, good.
Do you use scaffolding for your projects?
scissor lift.
Yeah, see, what we see common with scissor lifts is the guy standing on the midrail to get higher. Use the scissor lift, that's what it's for.
And
that's what we see.
We're investigating an accident. It wasn't a fatality, it was an accident where a gentleman felt they were resurfacing an existing bridge. They removed all of the old concrete, and what you do is you build a temporary platform in that bridge. Well, that's considered a scaffold under our standards. It's called a catch platform scaffold. And so they jumped from an elevated beam down onto the plywood, and they had broken when it went through, fell to the ground below. And this is stuff that I guess the contractor reused and reused. So we actually have it in our lab to examine it right now to make sure your platforms, your temporary platforms on a bridge job are sufficient.
Mm-hmm. Stronger standard on like the spacing of the 4x4 is a requirement that we have a general requirement that it stand 4 times the intended load. So the engineering is left up to you, but on this, I don't know if ODOT people can maybe chime in here, but there was a plan, and I would guess that you have to have a plan for that platform. There was an engineering plan on how everything was going to be spaced for the supports and the type of plywood that was being used. Mm-hmm. So make sure you follow your plan.
Yeah, and build it to the design, right? Yeah.
Yeah, that's right.
Yep. Okay, probably use ladders at some point in some of your projects, but just understanding there are different types and strengths of ladders that that you may want to have or need to have. Heavy duty ladders for heavier construction, just making sure that they're in good condition and employees know how to use them properly. We see a lot of violations involving ladders not being used properly, the wrong type of ladder. There are labels on these ladders for a reason, and a lot of the things we see are directly off the stickers on the ladder. Don't stand on the top rung of the ladder. Make sure you're using an appropriate ladder for the right job. Again, you know, face the ladder when you're going up and down it, and these are things you can go over in your general safety program. Don't lean a stepladder. We see this a lot. You know, they didn't want to take the time to go get the other ladder, and you know, I only needed to do one thing for a few minutes, so I'm just going to go ahead and use this ladder. So make sure that there is access to the appropriate type of ladder for the job, and that people know when to use certain ladders for, you know, types of situations. And this is, we do see this quite often. A lot in generally in construction. So people standing on the top of the ladder, and they should have gone and gotten a more appropriate ladder to reach what they're trying to work on. And there's usually a label on the ladder that says not to do this as they're standing on it. So, and then if you're working over a railing, there is a potential that if you fell off the ladder, you could fall to the next level. So making sure that employees doing this type of work are protected from a fall to the next level. This is just a little bit of information about bases of ladders. Make sure that you're using the right kind of feet base for your ladder and the conditions that you're working in. Skip that. Bridges. Bridge edges must be protected. I think we've kind of covered this. If there's water underneath, flotation devices are required. Yeah.
Is that regardless of the depth?
I don't know for sure. I think it's...
Well,
yeah.
Have you ever seen it?
Yeah, we don't. Yeah.
We've seen it.
And we've actually sighted it at a time.
It's
like a rescue boat.
Right. Mm-hmm. Some of the bigger waterways.
When there was water.
Yeah, there may not always be water.
To answer your question, we still have to prove a hazard.
Yeah.
So
we'd
have to consider.
If it's a foot, then.
Yeah.
Good.
Yeah, over there.
Yeah. Well, that's a substantial waterway. That's, yeah. Yeah.
There's actually even a regulation in I forget where it is in my planner, but if you have the work over water, you have to have a skiff boat available for rescue on project over water.
Another thing, if you're decking, make sure that you're protected during the entire decking process, and any of the leading edges are guarded, or personal fall arrest is used so that someone can fall off that edge before they can get that edge decked. This is another fall hazard. Employee not riding in their appropriate seat. And we see people riding in buckets down the street and things like that. So it's another fall hazard potential. And then this, I think, Stephen, you'll probably go over this, what a competent person is. So a competent person should be someone who can identify a fall hazard and correct a fall hazard if there is observed to be a fall hazard, and make sure that employees are using the proper fall protection to protect them from that potential hazard. And they should have the authority to stop work to correct that hazard. So there needs to be someone on site that can make sure that things that need to be addressed and corrected can be addressed and corrected. Okay. The focus four, or the fatal four, is what we just talked about, and they exist on just about every job site. And so it's very important to make sure that everyone on your crew understands each of those four topics of hazards and is aware and knows how to report them to you and get them corrected if they do observe something like that. And then I'm just going to go over a little bit of statistics and then I'll be done. Sorry, mine seems to have run a little bit long. But this is data on the number of construction fatalities from the year of 2011, which was the last data that I could find, the most recent that was actually published. So there were 738 total construction fatalities, and of that, 35% were fall hazards, electrocutions were 9%, struck bys were 10%, and caught-ins were 2%, and all others were 44%. And that kind of takes into consideration some of the maybe transportation-related injuries and fatalities in construction. So 9% was 9% was electrocution. Yeah, 9%. So.
This is
national, not state. Yeah, this is national. And then,
how many years is that?
It's just 11. It's just 11. Just 1 year.
I'm gonna go over the last 5 years. Yeah. In Oklahoma, but I don't have fancy pie charts.
Yeah, it took. Yeah. So here's what, and this is just for the standard industrial code, the SIC codes 1611, which is highway and street constructions except elevated highways. So these are what citations we're seeing in these here in this is national, just for this SIC code. And how I got this was I went on our website and pulled the data, which is public. You guys can look this up. And I typed in the SIC code 1611. And then put a year range in there. But this is just for our fiscal year 11. So the types of things that are being cited are our excavation requirement standard, which is 1926-651. Also, fall protection, duty to have fall protection. So these are all of our focus four hazards that we're seeing on site and actually citing. So to get a good grasp on the hazards you have on site, you can focus on those four things and catch a lot of, the major concerns that you're going to have. Rigging equipment for material, another trenching and excavation, and the protective systems. So that gives you kind of a good idea as to what to start looking for when you're addressing and improving your safety program. And this is the 1612, which is the bridge, I believe. Heavy construction other than building construction. So this is another similar SIC code to the other one that we just talked about. And what we're seeing there is wiring, design and protection, citation, so electrical, and then more electrical, and then fall protection. So there's our focus four again on our top citations, and that should be in your book. So if you want to look at those specifically, you'll have that. And then These are just kind of the general, I went through each of the Focus Four, and these are the general citations that we're seeing most for the SIC codes starting with 1.6. So that's all construction, basically. We're seeing citations in wiring methods, components and equipment, and wiring design, and electrical power generation and transmission. So that gives you kind of another thing to focus on and learn more about with your programs. And then the most common struck by citations in that same SIC code 16 are head protection. So hard hats, making sure people are wearing their hard hats, and material handling equipment. So there's another one of our focus four. And then criteria for personal protective equipment. So that's personal PPE, basically. And then this is for caught between in our construction SIC code. And that's our excavation requirement again, which we've talked about a lot. Protective systems, which is another one for our excavation standard. And then material handling equipment. So these are all in our focus four that we've talked about. And then lastly is the fall protection. These are what we're seeing most often is duty to have fall protection, ladders, aerial lifts, and fall protection systems and criteria. So making sure that your fall protection system is appropriate and adequate. And this is just a couple final statistics before David's. The fatal four were responsible for 3 out of 5 construction fatalities in the year 2011. And eliminating the fatal four would save 419 workers' lives each year. So that's a good reason to start focusing on those as you're improving your safety and health plan. And then the NIOSH Fatality and Assessment Program, FACE has examples of our Focus Four fatalities that we have done investigations on, and David was gonna talk about some of the ones that have occurred in Oklahoma specifically in the last several years. So that's all.
Good site.
Yes.
NIOSH does a lot of good stuff. They're not part of OSHA, but they do, they're like the research. And they'll go out. And you can actually invite them out to one of your job sites. Some of the oil and gas companies here in Oklahoma have invited NIOSH out to do sampling. When they're fracking out there, you heard of fracking? When they're fracking, they're using sand that contains silica. You probably have employees that may deal with silica when they're cutting concrete. But they've gone out to some of the fracking jobs in Oklahoma and sampled for employee exposure to silica, and they have a whole report on it. So anything they do, they'll write reports, and they're very helpful with photographs, analyzing the job sites. So it's a good resource.
Yep.
Thank you, Megan.
I forgot to do this earlier. Everybody know that there's a state OSHA as well. We're federal. We're the enforcement branch. The state Oklahoma Department of Labor has a consultation service. And they're, you know, not to say we're bad guys, because we have good cooperative programs. We do issue citations. They don't issue citations. But you have to invite them out. So if you have a job site that you want them to look at, if you have a program you want them to help you audit and improve, if you have some training, they can help you, but you got to call them. So Diana Jones is my counterpart over there. She runs the Safety Pays program, and also DOT. I don't know if they have PIOSH, the public employees. They have jurisdiction over city, state, county, municipal employees, where we don't. We have no jurisdiction over state, city agencies. We do over federal agencies, but so they would also help you guys if you need help as well. But we meet every year and plan our activities. So we just don't, I don't know if when you were watching Megan's presentation, what we issue citations for, we're not out there just willy-nilly looking at, we know where we need to focus. We analyze every year, where are the accidents and fatalities happening? We have 16 emphasis programs in Region 6, our 5 state, we're part of a 5 state region out of Dallas, and we have 16 emphasis programs that we're active in. So we know we need to concentrate on oil and gas, falls in construction, highway work zone, because that's where we're having. So there's 16 of those. Okay. If you need to know what those are, those are public knowledge. I can get those for you. But we meet every year, and we try to unify on where to focus. So wherever we're doing enforcement, they'll try to do some consultation as well. So call them. We work really closely with them. A lot of times we do speeches together. I just did a speech here on this campus about a month ago with they have a teen safety coordinator because there's so many teens that do summer work and they get hurt on the job. Now you'd be surprised how many fatalities we have with teens working summer jobs. So they have a teen safety person, and we gave a seminar to the Career Tech. What's the high school?
Huh?
Lester. You know Lester? And he and I give a talk together about it to all the teachers in the high school so they can do this program. So they do a lot of good stuff anyway. So we do a lot of stuff together. Okay. So I went 5 years back from 08 to the present, and we have investigated 11 fatalities in the road and bridge industry. So we got highway. The two SIC codes that Megan was talking about, they're broken down into highway and bridge. And then bridge includes elevated highways as well. So if you take probably about this back row and right here, or we can do this if you guys, but that's how many people didn't go home alive. You'd rather me do this, right? So you got, that's how many people didn't go home in your industry over the last 5 years. So, 8 of those were in the highway side, and 3 of those on the bridge side, okay? And I'm going to kind of go over what's happening, but you can see right away, right here, 5 run over on this, in this industry, 2 run over here. So 7 of these 11 over the last 5 years have been struck by or run over equipment or vehicles. So that's what's happening out there. Let's look at some of them. So on the highway side, you know, we got motorists that are striking other equipment. So this is a contractor over in eastern Oklahoma that had an aeroboard vehicle, and a public vehicle crashed into that aeroboard vehicle, and then it pushed that construction aeroboard vehicle into the work zone and struck an employee and killed him. So we've got dump trucks within the work zone that are backing over employees. We had that happen a couple times. This one happened in Yukon, and it was toward the end of the end of the rush hour and before they closed the lanes. So they had started work prior to closing the lane and putting their barricades up. And 2 employees were on the shoulder shoveling gravel, and a motorist swerved onto the shoulder and struck both employees and killed them. And then here's a service truck. This happened actually in the yard. So this is not, we don't just investigate out on the job sites, on the highway job sites, but if you have an accident, a fatality in your yard, we investigate those too. And this was a paving contractor in their company yard, and they had pulled a vehicle around. I think they were jumping a battery or something. And instead of circling back around and parking it, they backed all the way across the yard. And someone walked behind him while he was backing that service truck up and backed over him in their yard. So I guess the lesson learned there is limit your backup distances if you can. You know, he could have pulled around and then backed a short distance. This one happened in the evening up in Tulsa. An employee went out by themselves and they were cutting some concrete, and a motorist crashed through the work zone and struck them while they were cutting the concrete. So those are the highway. The bridge ones run over, struck by, that it's happened in the state in the last 5 years. Here's a dirt scraper on a bridge project that was operated by. So you've got multiple employers. We have something called a multi-employer worksite policy. So we're going to look at everybody's responsibility when we go out and make an inspection. So we're going to look at the GC, how are they controlling that job, and we're going to look at all the subs. So this is the reason why, because you've got certain activities like operating equipment that one contractor may be doing that may be exposing your employees. So you need to figure out how you're all going to work safely together, and we look at that on all of our inspections. here's a spotter that got struck by a dump truck on a job site inside the work zone. So then the other events that have happened besides being run over or struck by, this was a skid steer bobcat. This happened in the company yard as well, and this was a road contractor. You've seen these little bobcats, right? And you sit in the seat. Apparently, this employee ended up leaned out over the front, and the arm came down and crushed him between the frame. And now, this had a safety switch on it. So in other words, if you weren't sitting in the seat buckled, seatbelt buckled, the hydraulics would not work. So the manufacturers put these. Now, some, I think, may have a trigger in the seat. This one had it in the seatbelt. So guess what happened here? Buckled behind him.
The new ones have the arm that comes in.
Like a roller coaster arm?
Yeah, and if you raise, you can't, if you're in it, you can't.
It's good. So it's a good. That's a positive restraint rather than a belt.
If you raise it,
it's good. That is good. But no, you've got equipment like that out there. And so the seatbelt was buckled behind him, and it allowed him to lean out over the front. And this is something, I guess, I don't know, it may seem unusual, but I know, you know, your asphalt dump trucks back up to the paver shuttle buggy, and they raise their bucket. Well, this one had a clamp. I don't know if they all work this way, but they clamp the back wheels to the so they can push it along, and it was misaligned, and it punctured one of the back tires, and an employee actually was standing there when it released. He got hit by fragments of the tire and killed him. This one, I think Megan spoke about this one. This is a bridge contractor that was removing a section of the boom of a crane on the bridge job and knocked out that last pin. They had the boom laid down horizontally and didn't have both sections cribbed up, supported. They knocked the last pin out, and it scissored down, and he was underneath it, and he got struck by. And then this one was, we felt it was heat-related, so we investigated it. You gotta know, when your employees are working out there in the hot summer, we have heat-related fatalities nationwide all the time. We had one, it was reported yesterday on our area director call that happened in Arkansas on oil and gas side over there. So watch your employees. We weren't able to link this. We rely on the medical examiner's report on cause of death. So if it was heat, we probably wouldn't have been able to investigate this further as a heat related. But the employee was working, was doing some strenuous work, shoveling. It was a hot day and became ill and went and sat in the truck and did not recover and died. But we weren't able to really, but I leave it in here, and we called it natural causes at the end, but I leave it in here because it's a real element you guys have to deal with out there. So, you know, employees have to stay hydrated. You know, they may need to take more breaks in the hot summer. Acclimation is key. I mean, I've seen over my 30 years with OSHA, I've seen a number of heat-related deaths that were work-related, and most of them is the person's first day on the job or right after they've been off for a while. We had one where they were off for a week, came back from vacation, first day back, they've lost their acclimation. So the body just has to get used to working in that.
I wanted to say, if you have someone that leaves work because they're sick, check on them. Don't let them go sit in a car like this person did. I personally investigated an instance where they let someone go sit in the vehicle, but they didn't go check on them. And had they gotten this person's medical attention maybe 30 minutes later, he'd probably be alive today. So if you have somebody that does feel like they're getting heat illness, check on them. Make sure they're doing okay so you can get them attention if they need it.
And that was acclimation, too. That was a crew that drove from Ohio, or it was in the 70s, to Davis, Oklahoma, in an unair-conditioned car. Their first day on the job, 105 degrees. Yeah. This guy checks out about 2 o'clock in the afternoon. He was a young guy, right?
He made it a few hours in the car. And then had he gotten attention the time he felt initially sick, he'd be okay.
Do you think, what do you think the reason is for
or what have you found, I guess, the reasons for the high fatalities in this, in the bridge and in the highway? Is it, you know, just lack of education, just carelessness, I mean, all of the above? I mean,
I had an interview, I didn't tell them yet. I had an interview yesterday with a newspaper person about the fatalities in the oil and gas industry, and that's the kind of question. Those are hard to answer. When we do an investigation, we know what caused it. And we evaluate safety and health programs on each inspection. That's the kind of stuff that Stacy and the compliance officer staff do. But there's always room for improvement, and I can't pinpoint all 11 of these that there was a common thing wrong with their training or with their hazard recognition. But I'm going to go over the safety, you know, what your safety program should include and how to improve it. And hopefully that'll help. But I don't know how to answer that really. I mean, we know what caused them, but what is wrong in the safety system of each company is hard to pinpoint. If we did 5 years, they'd be similar. To put it in perspective, per year, we investigate between 25 and 30 fatalities in the state. And last year, oil and gas dominated that. They had about half of them. Construction only had 4 or 5, I think. This year, construction is the highest. It's up around 6. Oil and gas has dropped down to about 4.
Do you think that's directly related to the amount of activity that was going on in construction during that time versus the oil and gas?
Possibly. Could be. But I tell you, oil and gas, we stepped up our enforcement and we did what we call a stand down, and they got active with their safety and health because their drilling hasn't slowed down from last year. But if you look at national statistics, oil and gas has a fatality rate that's 7 times. Their injury and illness rates, like if you're your days away from work and restricted that you put on your OSHA 300 log, their days away where they have injuries that cause days away or restricted is low, very low. When they have something happen, it's bad. But their fatality rate is 7 times what other industries is. And that has not come down nationwide. They've reduced them here in Oklahoma. But anytime the rig count goes up nationally, the fatality rate goes up too. So I'm sure part of that is related. But this year, I think it's 2. We've had 2 road and bridge fatalities. You know, 2 of those 11, I think, were this year. Yeah.
Yeah, we're not even talking about amputations. I've got 2 of those.
Right.
We've
got, yeah. Right
now, then we've got
ongoing.
Yeah.
That's just,
well, yeah, at least
serious stuff.
Becco.
Where they don't die.
Yeah.
Well, that one wasn't road and bridge. That was pipeline.
Transmission. Yeah.
Yeah.
So there's, I think we've 2 this year out of, we've investigated 20, are we up to 26? 26 fatalities so far. We do fiscal year October to October. So we're about done for the year. We've got 2 more weeks before we start counting again. And so 26, 2 of those are road and bridge fatalities. So questions? We're gonna take a break. Did you have something? Found this like from a Navy shipyard policy. So since there were so many struck by, run over by equipment, this is kind of a good guideline. And I didn't send this to Victoria to include in your package. So I'll send it to her. So if you want this, make sure she's got your email. She said she could email it to you. Okay. So this just goes through each type of equipment and shows the approach distance for for workers working around each piece of equipment, the safe approach distance, and you can see it extends out where the operator can't see, so you're blind. It takes into account for the blind spots for each type of equipment. A man lift, here's a forklift, and you can see this is the type that's got the side boom here, so it may obstruct the view to the right, so therefore 85 feet all the way out this way. So, and you know, when we look at each of these cases and investigate them, we're looking at the training of the operator, but what we don't have benefit of is you know, what was that worker that was on foot thinking? So we're going to talk about your safety and health program, and Stephen's going to talk about training. If we can't talk to that person, what do you need to show us that he's been trained, he or she's been trained? You need a training record somewhere. So we're going to talk about documenting your safety program, but it would be important to know that they've been through some type of training. So if you've got a document like this where you go through and train them and they sign off on it, that might be a good tool for you. You know, the backside of this equipment is the furthest approach distance. You know, all of this is consistent. There's a larger forklift. So anyway, I'll send this off. Here's one that's the Bobcat type that we had the fatality on, but you know, you've got the side arm here that's obstructing the view back this way.
Are you going to talk about, and I apologize if you've already talked about it, potential fines?
We have not talked about that. And that's not even in my program, but I'll be glad to talk about it. So remind me later, and we'll talk about that. So at the very end, we can escape out the door, hasn't it? No, we can talk about that. Just remind me later, okay? All right. Trucks and trailers, vac trucks that clean up the parking lots. You know, anyway, all the dump trucks. So anyway, I'll send this to, I'm not going to go through all these, but I'll send this to Victoria, and this is the one I found late and didn't get to you. So all right, we're going to talk about safety and health programs, and how many have a written program? I know I asked that earlier. There's a few of you, okay. Talk about all the skeletal bones, but what you're trying to do with a safety program is you're trying to develop a culture. So, you know, I talked about our VPP program. Those are companies that have elite programs, or actually systems. You know, I like the word system, safety and health system, because a program, you think of a written program, it's in a binder on a shelf somewhere. A system is something that's always moving, and you're improving, and you're auditing, and it's being improved all the time. So what you're trying to do with your safety system is you're trying to develop a culture where the employees have bought into safety and health. So we're going to go through how you accomplish that and what it looks like. So we're going to talk about this. There's two things here, and you've got this first one in your binder. I think it's at the very back. And back in 89, OSHA came out with a safety and health program management guideline document. And what it does, it goes through all the major elements of a safety and health system for you to develop one. So that's in your book. If you do not have a program, it will help you develop one. If you have one, it'll help you audit what you've got and improve on it. So, yes.
Can you do a commercial?
Certainly.
Next Thursday, we're having a class with Keith Kohlinger, and one of the things that we will do in that class is work on a safety program, a written one, and we have a template for you. So if you're interested.
Very good. Very good. Yeah, because I was anticipating getting questions. Well, if I'm a small employer, which I think everybody is here, you know, how do I get a sample? So that's good. And I've got a couple sources here, too, that I'll show you at the very end of this. But that's one tool for you. And this is the other, which I didn't include in your thing, but you can go onto our website, and look up directives, and look up this directive right here on our on the OSHA website. And this is actually what our compliance officers use and are trained on to evaluate your program before we issue citations. So each inspection we do, if you've got a safety program of some sort, we're going to evaluate it. We're going to go through all the elements and evaluate it, and this is how we do that. So that would be good for you to have so you can see, you know, go through it before we get there, you know, in case we ever do come. And that's what that, the one that's in the back of your binder, that's what it looks like right there. Okay. Why do you want to have a safety and health system? Why do you want to have a safety culture in your workplace? If you reduce your injuries and illnesses, it affects your morale and productivity, and also reduces what you're paying out on workers' comp costs, and which is a big issue these days. I mean, the state consultation has a program called Safety Pays, and that'll help you drive this down. It goes directly toward reducing your costs. And it's not just what you pay out. You know, if you have a workers' comp claim by one of your employees, an injury on the job, and you have a workers' comp claim, what you pay out in money is just the surface. Underneath the water of that iceberg, it gets huge because it affects so many more things. You know, you may pay that out and say, okay, I got that behind me. Next year, what's your mod rate going to be? Do you have to replace that employee? Do you lose productivity with that employee? You know, so there's a lot of additional costs. And what that Safety Pays program does is it carries you through all that and lets you realize exactly what one injury costs. So savings there, and also a comprehensive safety and health system can reduce injuries and illnesses by 20%. So if you get the program together, get the culture in place, and it's working. So what you're going to do is you're going to, when you develop your safety and health system, it's going to assign responsibilities to managers, supervisors, and you're going to hold employees accountable too. There's certain things that they have to do and follow. Who has, those of you that have safety programs, do you have rules in there? You know, most safety and health programs that we see and evaluate out there, they've got a list of rules somewhere.
Can a competent person be held personally responsible if he sees an act and doesn't act upon that?
Are you talking about an employer or a manager?
Employee level.
An employee level? Well,
if he's the competent person on the job, has there ever been precedent set where he could potentially become liable?
You're talking about a third party lawsuit?
If he saw, well, even from
promotion? No, we don't. Okay. We don't issue penalties or citations to individuals. Or an employee. It is a company that's responsible for those employees. Now, we do have something called employee misconduct. And so if you have a safety and health system, we're going to talk a little bit about this, but this falls under your hazard prevention and control, where you have to have a disciplinary system in place. So if you have safety rules, you've established those, you've trained your employees and communicated those safety work rules to the employees, you're doing regular inspections to make sure that everyone's following that, and you have disciplinary action and you enforce those work rules. If you do all of those things and you have an employee violate one of those that causes an accident and we're investigating, we can, if you have all those elements in place and documented, it's employee misconduct and you don't get a citation, but we don't issue citations to that employee. That answer,
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. So that's part of why you want to orient and train your employees, is to protect yourself, and also you don't want to have the injuries anyway. And regular inspections is part of the safety system too. We're going to break all of these down. So an effective program includes a systematic system for identifying, evaluating, and controlling your hazards out there on your job sites. And it goes beyond specific requirements of the law to address all the hazards. So you're looking at a culture, not just you just want to comply with all of our regulations. You want to go above and beyond that with this. So we're going to talk about, too, about job hazard analysis on how you can do that as part of your safety system. But this is kind of an example, this little chart over here, where you analyze the job or the task. You identify the hazards associated with that, and then you come up with how you're going to control it. So that's a very simplified JHA right there. So you have a written program. It being in writing is not as important as what you're practicing out there. You know, I don't know how many places we go to where we say, do you have a written program? Yeah, we do. And, well, let me take a look at it. And they knock the dust off of it and pull it out of off of a shelf somewhere. And where it really matters is when we get out on our inspection in the field and we start interviewing the employees and asking them questions about that program, that makes the biggest difference. So if they know, yeah, we have training, yeah, we do regular inspections, yeah, I can complain about safety and things get corrected. You know, those are the type of things that show it's not just a program on the shelf, but it's actually engaged out in the field and on your work site. The problem is, though, the more complex, the more, I guess, as your company grows, the more need there is to have a written program. And, you know, if you're going to take the time and practice that, you might as well memorialize it, because somewhere along the way, your workers' comp carrier, or if a Stacy of the world shows up at your place, you got something to show her. So yeah, I've got a program. So if it's not in writing, it would probably behoove you to develop it.
And general contractors are asking for those more now.
Yes, exactly. Yeah, I got a call the other day. I didn't even know. You know, the oil and gas companies, they belong to this. And when they hire a contractor, they have something called ISNet World, ISN. And it's a company that vets all of their contractors. So in order to get hired by them, you got to submit all your injury and illness records and your safety programs to this one company, and they check you out for. And so you've got construction companies that do this, ISN. There's a company now that they called me the other day. They were trying to get a job at Georgia Pacific Paper Mill. There's a whole paper industry system that checks out contractors too. So you've got different companies that require you to have a written program. Exactly. So here are the four major elements of a safety program. So they're included in that document there at the back of your manual. And if you go to this training, is that a training session? Or this training session, they're probably going to hit on all these. So we're going to break each of these down here in the next 30 minutes or so. But these are the four elements. You got management commitment and employee involvement, work site analysis, hazard prevention and control, safety and health training. So sounds pretty simple, but as you start breaking these down and all the things that you have to do, that's another reason you may want to have it in writing, because there's a lot to keep up with when you start looking at this. The management commitment, it's a motivating force. So it's, you know, you hear companies say, well, our safety system is grassroots. The employees have bought into it. Well, if you don't have the top down, though, it's not going to work. I mean, the employees are not going to run the thing by themselves. So what you do in this safety program is you have some type of policy where you state that management is committed to safety and health and how you're going to do that and how you're going to control the hazards out there. And then somewhere in that opening statement about management commitment, employee involvement, is how you're going to get the employees involved in the safety and health at your facility. And we'll talk a little bit about how you can do that. So it establishes clear goals, your management commitment does, provides top management and with involvement, and assigns and communicates responsibilities for all aspects of the program by everyone. So part of getting employees involved is what are you going to do to get them involved? You know, what kind of encouragement are you going to give them? So this tells you a little bit about what they can do, okay? If you do regular inspections of your job site, are the employees involved in that? Can they be? What some companies do is they do safety committees. So you'll have a rotational method of assigning employees, and they're involved in the walkthroughs. And we'll talk about checklists later. You know, arm them with a checklist and get them involved. And you may have a safety person that does the inspections, but if you get employees walking with you, what does that tell the employees out there if they're walking with you and checking things? Do I? Exactly. Yes, and you care about their safety and health, and you want them to identify things, bring it forward. Developing and revising safety rules, training new hires. They can even assist in the accident investigation. One of those VPP companies that we were talking about earlier, they have a system in place. After an accident occurs, they put an accident investigation team together. It's the safety person, it's the foreman or the manager for that department, and then they put the person that got injured on that committee to investigate. So they're involved. That's part of this involvement. There's got to be some accountability by everyone. So, you know, what some companies do here is they make it part of their evaluation. So you're evaluating performance somehow every year, basing bonuses on it maybe. So you're going to make them accountable for safety. Your foreman and your employees. We talked about employee misconduct. You're going to make the employees responsible as well. You want to have something in place in your program where you're going to do an annual evaluation of that management commitment and employee involvement. What's working, what isn't working? What changes do you need to make to that policy? Any questions on employee involvement, management commitment? So it's basically a statement, how you're going to accomplish, how you're going to hold people accountable, and then you're going to audit that every year, okay? Worksite analysis. What is that? What is worksite analysis? What type of things? You know, it can be a variety of things, not only to identify hazards, but to look ahead and to predict things that might happen. So you're not only looking at, you're trying to find unsafe conditions or acts out there. You know that just because you remove a hazard from your work site, you may still have more because of behavior things. So many companies have gone to what they call behavior-based safety because studies have shown that a large percentage, 70% or more, of the accidents that happen out there are not because of the condition, but because of the unsafe act, the behavior of an employee, or the behavior of a supervisor that told the employee to do something unsafe. So if you take the approach that you're going to do behavior-based, then you're not only analyzing your job sites, trying to remove those physical hazards, but you're looking for unsafe acts, unsafe practices that the employees are doing or that your managers are doing. So, yes?
This is an example. If I had to do it, I don't know what example, but we had an employee involved in a single vehicle accident, drove off the roadway, had another employee in the vehicle with him. The policy is the other vehicle or the other individual doesn't sleep. They don't text, don't internet, whatever. You know, everybody's supposed to be alert. This guy drove off the roadway, ended up hitting the water tower, totaled the vehicle. Both of them were fine. After the fact, four different people said, I bet he fell asleep. After the fact, four different people said that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's what I was...
So what, yeah, exactly. Yeah, it's a good example.
The question I was getting at earlier, is it, you know, is it culture, is it behavior, is it, you know, carelessness, or is it lack of training? Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Maybe 70% is behavior.
Well, behavior may take into account all those things, you know. Yeah. So. So anyway, when you're doing your analysis, don't just look at current conditions either. Predict, anticipate. You know, if you think about safety, really, the best safety practice is imagination. One of our most complicated standards that we have is for refineries and chemical industries called process safety management. And there's a whole section in there where they have to do hazard operability studies. And what they're called what-ifs. That's what they call these studies. And what they're doing is they're going through their plant. And we have a regulation for them because how many refineries blow up and kill lots of people? You know, 23, 17. I've worked on a couple in Houston that a lot of people get killed on one explosion. So they have highly hazardous chemicals where a lot of things can happen. So they have to go through under this regulation and they have to do list what-ifs. What if this valve releases? Then that'll affect this. So the more you can anticipate and predict, what if this happens? And that policy you're talking about, you probably, either something has happened where an employee fell asleep and the other one could help, or you're anticipating and you're saying, what if, we'll just have the other guy stay awake in case he gets sleepy. So that's an example of, you know, anticipating.
Obviously.
Yeah, but you've got a policy and you got something to go back on now, and you correct that behavior. So let's talk about some of these. So we've got things that we can do to do worksite analysis, which is basically you're analyzing your workplaces. So what are some of the worksite analysis that you can do? What's one thing you can do on a regular basis? Here, let's list these. Okay, I'll get it started. One, who does regular inspections?
Competent persons.
Okay, but as a company, do you do regular inspections of your job sites? Okay, when you do them, what do you do? I mean, who does them?
We do a job audit.
The foreman?
Safety man.
Safety person? Okay. And do you document them? One of the things we do, and when I talk about citations and penalties, if you ever get a citation from OSHA, you're probably going to be sitting across the table from one of us three, Stephen, Megan, or myself. You can come in, and we can talk about those citations. We're given the authority and the ability to have you do some things to improve your safety and health system, and in return we reduce your penalties or change classifications or group things together and to alleviate some of the burden, especially if you're a small employer. But we're going to ask you to do things. And one of the common things is if you're not doing regular inspections of your job sites, or you're doing them and you're not documenting, we're going to ask you to do that, put it in the settlement agreement, and have you send them to us for 6 months. There's no OSHA requirement. You know, we'll get lawyers. I had a lawyer yesterday say, well, there's nothing in the, we're going to put this in the settlement agreement because I was giving them penalty reduction. And they said, there's nothing in the regulation that says we have to do this. I said, no, there's not. There's nothing that says I have to give you a penalty reduction either. So in order to get this, you're going to need to get in a good habit of doing inspections. So that we use this. What's another thing you can do? What's another worksite analysis you can do out there on your job sites? I'm going to put up a slide that's got all the answers on here in a minute, but I want to see how many that you're doing, because I know you do these things. Stacy's going to talk about something today.
About analyzing potential hazards.
Yes.
How about meetings?
Safety meetings, okay. All right. There may be, you know, that's not going to be on my list up here, but there could be some things that come out of the meeting. So think about that. Think about what could come out of a meeting. Who said something about trends? You said trends. That's your.
Review the results.
Okay. Where are you going to get that information? Review the results of what?
The documentation from your prior inspection.
Okay. All right. How about your injuries? Your logs. You're really close. So you're doing trend analysis from your injury and illness logs. How is that helping? How is that doing work site analysis? What are you doing there?
You're identifying your weaknesses.
Yeah, exactly. You're looking. If you had 5 injuries last year, and 3 of them were things in the eye, what change might you want to do? Make sure everybody's wearing their safety glasses. So your trend analysis. You know, looking at how many people cut concrete as part of their job. What's in the concrete?
Silica.
So before they get exposed, what do you want to know? What kind of an analysis do you want to do? Have you ever sampled? Sampling exposures. You're hanging a pump and you're sampling what they're breathing when they do that job.
Okay.
Now, most of the construction stuff, if you're doing the same thing every time, a guy's standing behind the concrete cutter and they're cutting so many feet, you could sample worst case scenario and you keep that in your records, and the state will do this for you
for free.
And your insurance carrier probably do it for you. Your workers' comp carrier has an industrial hygienist that'll do it. Because you don't want to wait till we get a complaint and we come out and sample for you, because then it might cost you a little bit more. But you will have those results.
Does wet sawing reduce that?
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
And that's what I meant to add is that qualifies as an engineering control.
We're going to talk about engineering controls too, but... So, if your practice is you only wet cut, that's what you want to sample. So that's
that. Silica, but will it go through a mask, just a regular
face mask? The dust mask that you use has to be approved for the dust that you're exposed to.
N95. What? As a good example, what happens is all of those masks, all the different ones, have what's called a protective factor.
Mm-hmm.
And so depending on once you sample, you go, okay, well, this is my level of exposure, so what level of protective factor do I need? And so maybe an N95 not going to be enough. In other circumstances, I think you have to evaluate that at the sample. That's why it's a good idea to sample.
Just pick the right type of protection. First thing you want to do is engineer it out. This gentleman, I'm sorry, I don't know, the names aren't up. This gentleman just brought up an engineering control or a work practice control where you may not even need personal protective equipment. As soon as you put employees in a respirator of some sort, now you got to have a program under our regulation. So if you can engineer it out where they're not overexposed, it's the best way, and keep that data. So, okay, we'll talk more about this. A little bit. It's another thing. What if you buy new equipment? You going to do some analysis on the hazards associated with that equipment? So before you buy something, or when you buy it, if it's going to pose a new hazard to your employees, you want to analyze that as part of your program and do a work site analysis on it. What else? I'm running out of things now, so. Guess I could look ahead. Okay, so periodic surveys, that's where we're doing that. New materials, equipment. It could be a material too, not just equipment. What could you buy that may pose a new hazard to employees? Huh?
Hazardous materials,
chemicals, exactly. So when you buy something you've never used before, what's it going to come with?
MSDS.
And that'll change next year to a safety data sheet, SDS. There's a new GHS that's taking place, phased in over the next 3 years, but this is just basic stuff, you know. Your safety data sheets will be different, and your labeling is now going to be a pictogram. So, but yeah, if you buy a new material that's going to pose a hazard, make sure you get that in your program. Perform routine JHAs. That's where you look at your tasks that you're doing, that your employees are doing, and see what the hazards are associated with it. So it's a simple analysis. Regular inspections, that was top of the list. This is a worksite analysis. Having a method for employees to bring concerns to you. That is a worksite analysis. You want them to feel comfortable bringing things to you because you would rather them identify. If you're going to train them, you know, Stephen's going to talk about training your employees. If you're going to train them, you want them to identify. You can't be, I don't know how many times I hear it at these informal conferences when an employer has, I got a crew, I can't watch all my crews. You can't watch all your crews. That's why you train them. So if you train them, you want them to feel free to come to you and try to get it corrected without fear of reprisal. So that is a worksite analysis, having a system in place where they can bring things forward. Accident investigations. Every accident you should investigate. How many have heard of near misses? So years ago, I forget what the guy's name was, but I can't remember. I remember stuff from college, but for every near miss, there's so many near misses. There's like 30 near misses that happen before an accident actually happens. So why do you think companies are recording near misses? They're trying to eliminate as many hazards as they can. And these are not just unsafe conditions, but they are unsafe acts, the behaviors. So anytime, you know, that's worksite analysis as well. So you can have a near miss system where you have employees report to you, I almost had this happen. Or a foreman identifies, hey, we had this happened today. It could have been serious. Could have caused an accident. So you want to record those as well. And this is what we talked about. Trend. So look at your logs every year. Look at your near misses every year and see where you need to make changes. This could result in training that you do, changes you make in the program. You may want to come up with checklists. Checklists are very, very helpful when it comes to getting employees involved. It gives them standard things to look for as part of the safety committee. So you may want to develop checklist. Questions on worksite analysis. We've covered quite a bit of stuff there. You've got it in your handout. Those are examples of things that you can do. The more of those you can do and accomplish, the better your program is going to be because you're trying to capture as much as you can to eliminate hazards. That's the idea behind the analysis. So what happens when you identify these? When you identify your vulnerabilities, your hazards out there, what's the next step? Hazard prevention and control. How are you going to eliminate those? So this is the part of your program where you track things to completion. Okay? So wherever you identify something in your program is triggered where you get it corrected and you do it in a timely manner. Why is timeliness important here? The longer that exists, the more what you have? Employee exposure is. When we make an inspection, one of the things that we analyze is exposure. We have to have exposure to have a violation. You know, first thing we got to have is a hazard. And then we got to have employee exposure. You could have a unguarded electrical panel out here in the middle of the project, nobody working around it. If we can't find that an employee is exposed to that, we don't have a violation. So we have to have, so the longer that goes, the more your exposure is. So getting them corrected in a timely manner is important. So we talked a little bit about this. So let's go into the first thing. You know, there's a hierarchy of what you want to do if you've got a hazard there. So the first thing you want to do is eliminate it. So if you can engineer it out and remove it from your workplace, that's the best way of doing it. And that's what you want to try to accomplish. Another way to do hazard prevention and control is to make sure that everything is understood, and you're training employees so they know that these hazards are being removed. So they want to come forward with their complaints, but how they're going to be removed, and you want to positively reinforce them for bringing these up. That's part of your hazard prevention and control too. And then, so how do you do this positive reinforcement? What do most companies have there that where they're going to positively reinforce incentives? Yeah. So you have some type of incentive for them for working safely and for bringing hazards forward to you. Something, you know, this usually applies to managers, but I guess it could apply to employees too. But some way to correct unsafe performance. So something in their evaluation system for working safely or working unsafely, there could be accountability there. And then the last thing is a disciplinary system enforcement. So once you've identified an unsafe act under your worksite analysis part, this is how you're going to eliminate or control it. It's through incentive programs, disciplinary systems. Okay. If you cannot engineer something out, here's your next step, the administrative controls or personal protective equipment. So, the N95, the respirator is one way. Another way is if you've got, I mentioned multi-employer work sites. We get into those situations, and you get into them where somebody else has created a hazard for your employees. You may not have the authority to correct it, but you may administratively have your employees avoid that area or avoid that hazard. And if that's possible, that's in an administrative control. If you can't get that corrected, trenching that Megan was talking about, if you didn't dig the trench, your employees are around it, and you can't get whoever dug it to barricade it, and you can't do it, you can get your employees to avoid some way. That's an administrative control, is removing them from it. Part of prevention and control is making sure the employees know what to do in case of an emergency. So you got emergency drills, shelter in place. We're having a shelter-in-place drill today in our office. Yeah. If it's this morning, we lucked out. If it's this afternoon, we have to shelter in place this afternoon. But being prepared for different types of emergencies. Also, having some type of medical program, first aid on the site. Are some of your job sites in remote areas where there's not...
Define remote area.
This standard is under.
That's been a question of mine for a year.
This standard is under the first aid, and it says emergency medical care within a reasonable amount of time, and I think it's the four minute.
I think there's an interpretation.
The interpretation on 4 minutes. Yes.
And that raises a good question. I just wrote myself a note because I saw on the news the other day that they said something about telling you that 11 minutes. It's going to take longer and longer
to get an ambulance.
That requires me to have CPR, first aid, first
yes.
responder.
Yes. So most of your oil and gas rigs out there, they're having, they got somebody trained in Red Cross first aid.
An AED on site, somebody trained with the AED.
Yeah.
No, but I mean, that's one of the things they're going to, though, yep. just to cover themselves.
Not yet.
But, you know, it's something that a lot of them are going to, though.
And the fire department gets there usually first, and they count. So,
yeah.
You know, they're trained and all that, and they'll start doing stuff.
But if they're on State Highway down in Binger, Oklahoma, they might have.
We're out in the county.
Yeah, exactly.
County road somewhere in the middle of nowhere.
Yep. So you may have to have somebody trained. So that's part of your prevention and control in your program, okay, to consider. Questions? So that's your hazard prevention control, your methods, how you're going to get a thing after you've identified. Now you're going to track them to completion in a timely manner. All right, training, and I don't want to steal any of your thunder, Stephen, but safety nail training needs to be part of your program, okay? It gives responsibilities on the different levels of personnel. So it's not only your employees you're training, but you got to train your managers too, your foremen out there. There's a certain level of training that they need so they know how to manage and identify hazards on the job site. What's one thing that do you think we see a lot of, the cards in the wallets? The OSHA 10 hours, OSHA 30 hours? There's a lot of OSHA ed centers now that teach these. They teach some on this campus, the training courses. So this gets them ready to identify and control things out there. So if you put your foreman through that, they're prepared. There's other training as well. I'm sure that DOT does training that would qualify as well. Can be incorporated into other training about performance and job practices, and also the complexity depends on the size of your work site, you know, how well they need to be trained. So you're holding your managers accountable once you've trained them and ensure that they understand. This is actually a regulation. You're in an industry, the construction industry, you have different regulations. Everybody know the 1910 is the general industry standards that OSHA has, and the 1926 standards is for construction. Well, 26.21B2 says this. You must train your employees to recognize, on how to recognize and avoid hazards in the workplace. Where we cite this a lot are on trenches. You got employees working in a trench, and they don't know about the signs to see, to tell when it's going to cave off, the fractures, the water at the bottom of the hole. You know, if they're not trained, we might issue a citation there. So there's a certain level of training that's required in your industry. Questions on safety and health training? Okay. Here are some resources. On OSHA's website, and this is in your book, but you'll have to go there to get all of this information and click on all these hyperlinks. But on OSHA's website, we have something called electronic tools, e-tools. This is interactive. So you click on these and you can get PowerPoint presentations. All of these are downloadable. There's nothing here that's copyrighted. OSHA shares everything on their website. If you go to this e-tool, the four elements that we just talked about, right there, you can click on them. It'll pull up examples of those sections on how to develop or how to make yours better. You can audit your program that you have to make sure that you've got those. There's an e-tool on construction that goes through a lot of the hazards that Megan talked about right here. Okay. More information and training. You can click on each of these hyperlinks and you'll get more information about each of those four hazards. There's another resource on our website called a Quick Start, and this is especially for new or smaller businesses. And it helps you find out what you need to comply with OSHA, and also helps you develop a safety and health system. You can click on construction right there, and it takes you to all of these hyperlinks as well. And it's going to go into worksite analysis, hazard prevention and control, how to set up a safety and health program, train your employees, what Stacy's going to talk about today, record keeping, recording, posting requirements. So all of this is available to you on the website. And this is actually Texas. I got this one from Texas, but the OSHA consultation program, they have a lot of tools, and so does Oklahoma Department of Labor. They have a lot of tools that will help you develop and improve your programs as well.
And I'm Stephen Kirby, and I'm going to try and go over some of the training requirements. One of the questions that we often get is, well, just exactly what do I have to train everybody on? And that's what we did in this PowerPoint, and so I'm going to add quite a bit to it, but the majority of these slides are we went through 1926 from start to end, and every standard that had a training component, or in the standard it says employees will be trained on, and that's what this is going to try and cover. And so, but some preliminary information and a couple of things that have been mentioned that have been brought up in the earlier ones. We really didn't go over the difference between competent and qualified, and so at the end, remind me, and we'll try to, if you've got some questions, we'll try to go, okay, what's the difference, when is it competent, when is it qualified, and which one for which thing, and things like that, and we'll try to answer those questions. And then another thing that we wanted to bring up, and our compliance officer is out there on site, and they do things, and a lot of the things that the employer will bring to us and go, well, things like, and this is one of the trade ones, but the tailgate topics, the toolbox talks, things like that. Well, here's my training, and they give us all these toolbox talks. And those really aren't training. Sometimes for some of the standards, they might qualify because they're very, very limited in scope and things like that. They're great for some of the things David was talking about in terms of the job site analysis, the hazard awareness, maybe refresher on the training. But for it to be standalone training, in most cases, is not. And unfortunately, you get some employers, especially some smaller employers out there, that are using those and thinking that's their training. And most of these training standards, actually, and when we get into them, we'll try to bring them up. Most of them need to be a little bit of classroom time, a little bit of seat time. Forklifts is a good example. It specifically says there is classroom component, and then there is a hands-on worksite assessment component. And so that's, in doing things like the toolbox talks, you're not covering those things.
Some of them actually say that they have to be trained on the requirements of this regulation.
Right.
Which means you got to go over that each part of that
each standard. Part of that standard, yeah. And it's the same thing. We sometimes, you know, they pull out your 10-hour card and go, well, here, I was trained. Here's my 10-hour card. When it's the same thing, that 10-hour card really is not going through each one of those standards and says, oh, well, you have to be trained on this. And they may only spend 10 minutes in that 10-hour card on, say, a particular component. And that's some of these won't apply to you. You go, well, we're never doing that. That's not part of our job. We're never going to come across that. Well, great, then that's really hopefully one of those standards that you don't have to worry about. So that's what this is going to try and do and be a resource so you can go through there and go, okay, which standards really have those training components? And this is just to reiterate in terms of construction, just a quick summary of some of the things Megan went over as well. We actually seen workplace injuries go down from 2011 to 2012. I'm sorry, actually go up from 2011 to 2012. 17% of all the fatalities in the U.S. in 2012, and this was some BLS numbers from this summer. So they lag 6 to 8 months by the time they get all the BLS's information out. It says of 122 of those then were highway work zones in 2012. So a lot of those, a significant number, and this is nationwide then. Six construction fatalities from October 1 to August 30th. And again, this is what we were talking about. David, we had four that were roadway? Yeah. So this is all our construction were six.
Mine just went further back.
And yours went further back, and we're a five-year summary. But so, and again, we see some of the things like Megan was going over, the falls and the struck and crushed by. So... This is a memorandum from to the regional administrators, and it was a reiteration from Dr. Michaels, our assistant secretary, and that OSHA policy that employees training required by the OSHA standards must be presented in a manner that employees can understand. And sort of the interpretation on that is if your employees speak Spanish, the training needs to be in Spanish. If they speak, you know, in different regions of the country, if they speak different languages and that's the only thing they understand, that's what the training needs to and has to be in. Okay? You run into that a lot of times where that's not always being provided and can become an issue. So the following then, and that's what the majority of these slides are, and it sort of goes through, starts at the beginning of 1926 and just goes through sequentially then which ones have a training component, and we'll kind of elaborate on each one as we go through them, and some a little more, some a little less. At very beginning then, 1926-20 is just basically the generic catch-all that says you do have to do this, okay? You've got to train each affected employee in the manner required by the standard, okay? And failure to train may be considered a separate violation. So you may get a violation for a scaffold violation. You may also get a training violation because you didn't train them in scaffolds. So, and they are separate citable violations then. So, and that's actually spelled out then in the standard itself, saying that is separate. So, and this is where we were talking about at the very beginning. We have some general requirements, and this is the one David mentioned just a second ago. We've got 21B2 shall instruct each employee in the recognition and avoidance of unsafe conditions and the regulations applicable to the work environment to control or eliminate any hazards. So if we go on site and based on interviews, the compliance officer out there visiting with employees, does interviews with your employees, and they have no idea, they've never been trained on the trench, they've never been trained on the fall hazard, they haven't been trained on whatever hazard is present, then that's a violation of 21B2. So. And then 21 then goes on then and actually is very specific and says, well, now here are some examples, one of them, and goes through each one of them then. Poisons, caustics, harmful substances. This is not in place of HAZCOM. This is not in place of the 1200 and 1910. This is just saying, okay, you do have some specifics out there in the construction industry. Pesticides, herbicides, things like that may be on the job site. And it's just making sure, reiterating that those have to be covered then. B4, plants and animals present. Not just the chemical hazards, but also the plant and animal hazards. Poison ivy. What else in Oklahoma? Anybody? Rattlesnakes. Scorpions. Spiders.
Everything.
Poison ivy. Poison oak. Poison sumac. Yeah. So that's actually a standard. They have to be instructed in those hazards and how to avoid them. Okay.
Does that speak ticks?
What's the one? Beware of ticks. Yeah. And exactly. So now we've got mosquitoes too with West Nile and Lyme disease and all those things. So yeah, all those, you know, are potential hazards that the standard says you've got to train and address. Okay. Flammable liquids, gases, toxic materials. Basically, you know, welding gases. You know, all those things are covered in things like the welding standard and all that. But they've also done a catch-all here and said, okay, just in case, maybe you're not welding, but some of those things are on site, then it's your responsibility to be trained in those things. Okay. Confined spaces. There's not a true confined space standard in 1926. However, there is a catch-all that says if you do have confined spaces and you're required to do something like that, they had to have had training on those and recognition of them and all the protective and emergency equipment requirements for those. So there's not a true confined space in the construction standard, but there is in that 21 training requirement, they have to be trained on it. And then just a quick definition, any space having a limited means of egress, subject to accumulation of toxic or flammable contaminants, oxygen deficient. So anything, and you can go into the 1910 and you can go online and you can see there's entrapment, engulfment, IDLH, which is immediately dangerous to life and health atmospheres. So sometimes you may come across those situations, okay? Especially trenching. Trenching may, depending on the nature of the excavation, that trench may become a confined space. And again, here it mentions storage tanks, vessels, bins, boilers, ducts, sewers, underground utility, tunnels, pipelines, okay, and all the things that may qualify and become an issue in terms of confined space. 35E, the emergency action plans, which is a couple of things that we mentioned a while ago then, the requirements related to safety training for I'm drawing a blank.
Who you call.
Who you call, right. The first aid training, all those things. So, again, you have to have an emergency action plan. Then you have to train your employees on the emergency action plan. The standard says you can't just have it in paper. You've got to train them on it. Okay? Who's designated? Who's responsible for what? Yeah. And the last thing you want to have happen is only one person trained in first aid, and that's the one that's injured and down. So that becomes an issue as well. Medical service and first aid, and here's what we're talking about in the absence of and that time frame. Okay, the first aid training verified, okay, available at the work site. HAZCOM training, and basically is saying that you have to follow everything under 1910-1200, which is the HAZCOM. So instead of rewriting the 1200 HAZCOM, they're just using a standard saying you got to do 1200, okay, and everything in it. So, and again, that's the one where we get into all, you know, the requirements for the MSDSs, all the training on the chemical recognition, the chemical hazards, and things like that. So, and again, is just incorporated by reference in 55. You may come across this, especially on some of the highway, if you're doing any older bridges and you're remodding or paint stripping, sandblasting some of the old bridge beams. You know, depending on their age, lead may be an issue. Okay, do a lead assessment, a lead abatement, and HAZCOM training specifically related to the lead in those places, and it does exist out there on some of our older bridges. So, train to the hazards, specifically that there are reproductive and development hazards. Lead can affect the central nervous system. Kidney effects, blood effects, toxicity effects, so all the things related to the lead standard, then training on how those can affect the employee. There is an action level, and that's one of the things on the testing. If you think you're going to be working anything like that, then actual sampling exposure to see if there is lead there. And then trying to engineer those things out, trying to use PPE, whatever you can do to eliminate the hazard as much as possible and then protect from it. And the training then to make sure that they understand the hazards that are there and the protective measures that you're going to put in place. So. 103, respiratory. Same thing then, if you are going to put them in that N95, if you're going to put them in any other level of respirator then, 103 says, then you basically have to follow 134, which has all the training requirements, all the fit test requirements, all the things associated with respirators now you've got to follow in the general industry based on a 1926-103. And again, that's why we'd like to see and preferably the engineering and administrative controls. If you can get rid of the hazard that way, then it saves you time and effort and concern with having to follow the respiratory.
Would you talk about the voluntary, for comfort only?
Oh, right. We run into that. There is an option if you're not requiring it, but you are providing it to them because they choose to wear it. Oh, please, you know, I want to wear it. It's an issue for personal preferences or whatever. There is an addendum at the end of 134 that you have to provide to the employee. Okay, is it a
Appendix D.
Appendix D, right. And so Appendix D then is you have to document that it was provided to them and that you did a little bit of training and they understand it, that it is a voluntary use for the respirator. So, but But that, and that is, that's really the only requirement. If they are using it voluntarily and you are providing it, then you don't have to follow anything else in 134, but you do have to provide that appendix. So is that pretty much it on that?
No.
Yeah, you don't have medical surveillance. Right. Now the lead standard, some of the lead and stuff like that do have a blood level. If you do get overexposures and things like that, then all the lead standard stuff begins to take effect. But hopefully, you know, you'll be able to engineer it out and eliminate any of those lead hazards if possible. But if you do get involved in any lead abatement or working on bridges that would have lead and have exposures for lead, then all the lead standard kicks in and you have issues there. So 201 then starts the work zone safety and basically signal flaggers, all the training for there, warning garments worn, all that training, basically following the MUCTD. Yeah, they have, but does our standard still reference 88 or does it, what is it? 2000? Okay.
I think we've
incorporated the new one, 2000? Okay. Yes. Yeah.
What's ODOT using? What's the latest MUTCD? Is there something after?
After 2000?
Yeah, I'm sure there is.
I'm sure there is, but it hasn't been incorporated yet.
Yeah. Behind we lag.
Yeah.
Do you know?
I don't even know what that is.
Oh, okay.
Oh, it's basically a fairly thick book, and it's all the descriptive and all the requirements for the flagging, for the work zone safety, setting up cones, setting up all the signage.
It's the blue book, so it's the old one.
Okay. So, all right. So that's what that actually is the MUTCD, and so in 201A it references it, so we can write violations on basically anything that's in that code book. Is it there's a couple of newer versions, but like David said, our standard tends to lag too a little bit as to which one.
We updated from 88.
Yeah. Okay.
I think most people are using the new edition. That's what I thought. There's an 09.
Is there an 09? Okay.
Yeah.
There's an 09.
Okay.
I'm just trying to think what was on my shelf.
Yeah. But here's a good example though, if we do have an emphasis program on work zone safety. If one of our compliance officers is driving by and there's a guy out there waving his hands and there's a couple of cones, they're gonna stop and do an inspection, and if he's not got the right high-vis stuff on, if he's not using the proper paddles and signage, all those things. And one of the questions is, you're out here doing traffic control, have you been trained? To what level have you been trained? Then there's multiple violations there, not just on following that, but then also on providing the training for those flaggers and signalers. Okay.
And a lot of people get third party to set that stuff up, but once they initially set up, the contractor starts moving it around, adjusting it. So then that's where your people need to be trained, because they are starting to
change it, alter it. Distances are changing, right? Exactly. you set it up initially, right? So, but and then again, what happens is something changes. Oh, we're gonna have to. We didn't plan on this, and I need to impede over into the next lane a little bit. I need to get a signaler out there because I've got a cement truck that's going to have to back in because of what I'm doing, and all of a sudden, you know, you've got somebody out there trying to stop traffic for the cement truck, and he hasn't got a clue what he's doing. You know, he doesn't have all the required training. He doesn't have these paddles. He doesn't have his signal. The signs don't match now. So, okay. So there is training on that.
We had one where there was road work being done.
Yeah.
The contractor got finished and took the work zone.
To call the stuff away.
Barricades down and left the guardrail company out there unprotected.
Unprotected, and they were working on a guardrail on the shoulder.
Down that highway, there was the guardrail crew.
That never happens.
Well, yeah. But
the movie,
you know,
was being filmed or something. Yeah.
And it's,
yeah.
That's true.
Yeah. So, yeah. So, and realize too then, yeah, we do have an emphasis on this, so we're obligated. If we see that, we are obligated to stop and do an inspection, and usually results in violations. If we've seen something and have a reason to stop, then it means there was a violation there, and that usually result.
I'm
go ahead.
Do you guys require any kind of certification?
There's not truly a certification, but it's back to that document in the training. And one of the things on the training, if it's not documented, if it's not in writing ahead of time, then it didn't happen.
Okay, because I know some other states, they do have, you know, a certification for flaggers.
Right, I don't believe.
It's not adopted that yet.
Yeah, so and so we're not enforcing anything like that. But we would look at the training, though, and, you know, documented, okay, this is the curriculum that was covered, this was the sign-in sheet, who was trained, what day, you know, to what level they were trained. All those things to verify that it actually happened. So, not just a toolbox talk that morning, hey, be careful, you're going to be controlling traffic today. That's, you know, so. We skip over, now here's one of them, and it was mentioned, actually this is one of the items that Megan had where one of the struck by hazards. Power actuated tools with the powder charge have a specific training requirement. Only employees who have had specific training in the use of those tools are allowed to use them. You know, one of the helpers or whatever picks it up and uses it, that's a violation if he hadn't been trained in it. So, and then again, if you're not, anybody not realize what these are? And I don't know if you use them that much out on the road and bridge work. So they usually have basically the little, what, almost like a 22 short shell with a powder charge in it to drive things. Woodworking tools, then, they have a specific, when you get over into woodworking tools, there is a specific standard in there that you can't use those unless you've received specific training and instruction on the hazard and use of the machine. So maybe, probably not often out in roadway work, but there may be times when you've got something there if you're building those forms, building some of the scaffold, things like that, so you've got some possibility here. Gas welding and cutting. Again, specific training then, D1 through D6, instruct employees in safe use of welding equipment, including, you know, fire hazards, fire watch, you know, the recognition of gas and oxygen hose and distinguish between them. The shielding, the cables insulated, the repair splices, training on all the requirements then of what constitutes safe welding and cutting. And so there is a specific in the welding that says you've got to train on that.
Can I ask you about welding?
Go ahead, yeah.
If that welder comes with their certification, we hire a brand new welder, they've got their certification.
Right.
Is that training sufficient?
We'd have to look at it. You'd almost become that multi-employer thing, and it would be an issue of you doing due diligence to verify that they were qualified and trained. Yeah, exactly. Come from a reputable company, and that's why a lot of these companies, the bigger, have gone to that ISNet world, because then that covers that for them. Hey, I used ISNet world and they vetted and screened those, so that was, you know, I was reasonably assured they were qualified and trained for what I hired them to do. So now, same thing if you just hire somebody off the street, you know, then you know you've got a level of responsibility there to verify that they are trained and qualified. So, and that pretty much goes to anything. If you get into a scaffold builder, you're going to hire somebody to put up scaffold for you. You know, if they're a reputable company, then you can, you know, be fairly sure that they're qualified for what they're doing. Ground fault, and so we'll get to the end of this in a little bit. And we'll try to make sure if somebody's not sure. In the ground fault, in the electrical standards, you have to designate a competent person, somebody who's going to evaluate that and do those spot checks or those daily inspections, things for like the grounding programs and the electrical conditions. So so that's not necessarily a true training program, but you have to have and be able to justify who's qualified, who's competent. Have I established that they are, and how have I established that they are? So, scaffolding is the same way. It talks about doing inspections and training for the person who is qualified in it, who's our competent person, who's your qualified person, the training for the scaffold hazards and the fall hazards that are there. So there is some components in scaffolding where there are specific training requirements. Each employee who's involved in erecting, disassembling, moving, operating, repairing, maintaining, or inspecting a scaffold shall be trained by a competent person to recognize any hazards associated with the work in question. So, and again, we'll try to distinguish competent and qualified when we get through with all this, because it comes up in several places where sometimes it's one, sometimes it's the other, sometimes it's both. And what sort of qualifies as that. So, fall protection. You have to provide training on the fall protection then. Employers shall provide a training program for each employee who's exposed to fall hazards. So if you're going to put them up there, be it behind a guardrail, using personal fall protection, using that warning line and monitor, you have to train the employees on recognition of hazards, the requirements of the standard for the fall protection, okay, and procedures and all that during, depending on what type of fall protection they're using. So, and again, it's specific for the training requirement. And this is a deal and kind of a little thing. A lot of people, we do get this. Well, it wasn't a steep roof. It was a low pitch roof. Why I didn't have to be up there. Or it was a flat roof. What's a different thing? So that in construction, it's anything over 6 feet. If you're on a scaffold, it's anything over 10 feet. Right. If you're doing connecting work with steel erection, it's anything over 15 feet.
Are you referring to floor height?
Actually, it's the potential fall. So if they are on, say, a higher level, say a second or third floor, and it's their fall to the lower level. Right. So is where they...
To the next level,
right, yeah. So it's not necessarily to the ground. It's whatever to their next level they would fall. Okay. Yeah, so. And I believe on the steel erection, is it between 15 and 30, if they're doing connecting work, they have to have the harness on, but don't have to be tied off.
Yeah, 30 feet for connector.
And so there's a window in there that's sort of, they have to have it available and on, but not necessarily connected.
So if you're decking a bridge, what's that considered? Yeah, but I'm talking about like
the, and there's actually also, and I would have to go read, there's a controlled decking zone in the steel erection. Exactly. It depends on what phase and.
It depends on what phase of construction is there.
No, they don't.
Right, because the definition of steel erection tells you what processes is covered by
right.
Standard. Now,
and then when you're pouring, it's
concrete.
Mm-hmm. Right.
You may fall into the concrete standard.
Exactly. So you're no longer connecting. But again, in there a caveat about the controlled decking zone. If you've established a controlled decking zone. Right, so there's...
And then remember that we're minimal.
Yeah.
ODOT may require something above and beyond us.
Yeah.
In their contract, I don't know how that works, but I know some GCs require above and beyond us.
And exactly, a lot of GCs will just go...
6 foot?
6 foot, tie off, harness up, we don't care.
You know, over the years, it's amazing how many steel erection companies now, use aerial lifts to do what they used to just hang from their toenails.
Yeah.
A lot of stuff from aerial lifts. So. They're in a protected, if they stay on the platform.
If they stay where they're supposed to be, yeah.
Exactly. And then they want you tied off to it, but then how many times do you get on, did someone say the mid-rail? I've done it a million times, and I know
Shame
it's supposed
you.
To.
You need an extra 6 inches and you can't reach it, so. So anyway, that's the idea there is training so that for that reason in construction there are three or four different levels that to meet the requirement, you know, where am I at and what am I doing and what equipment am I using, the fall height requirements vary. And so that's another reason for the training, and another reason a lot of the GCs have just gone to 6 foot. I'm not going to worry about it. If you're not tied off at 6 foot, then, you know, to eliminate that uncertainty. So
I'm just curious, if any of the bridge work, we see any nets? I don't see a lot of nets anymore.
No.
It depends on what it's over.
Yeah.
You're over traffic, yes.
I can see that.
Lots of times you're on traffic, but
that catch platform.
Yeah,
the floored.
Yeah.
Yeah. So.
And there are differences between debris nets and personal protective equipment nets, too.
Yeah. And the other one on this that we run against, and we mentioned it, is the articulating boom lift, harness and lanyard tied off. Scissor lift, not. They do not have to wear, according to the standard, do not have to wear a harness in a vertical scissor lift. But in an in a boom, you do.
Right. Scissor, you don't.
Scissor, you don't.
But the chain has to be.
Right. The gate has to be shut, or the chain has to be shut. Right. So, and you know, I don't know what the rationale is. That I guess maybe the scissor lift is really not meant to be moved vertically or whatever. Only raise and lower, come back down, then move, and then back up.
The safety switches on scissor lifts come down and contact.
Right. So they can't move it. Yeah. Right, where you're elevated, right.
The problem is now they have the ones that are off terrain now.
Right.
And the tip hazard is greater on those because they put, you know, the tires that are filled with air and, I mean, you know, get them on.
On soft soil or uneven soil, right. Yeah.
And you still have people hanging out of them.
Yeah. Articulating boom can catapult you out with investigative fatalities.
Yeah.
That's why you're tying off.
And that's why you're tying off in it, right.
So. I've seen them used as pulling devices, tree trimmer.
Mm-hmm.
They a limb, they cut a limb and it hung, so they throw a rope around it and they use the bucket to pull on it.
Yeah.
And so he had pressure on that bucket, and when it let go, boom, it bounced him right out of it. He wasn't tied off.
So, and that's why, you know, training on the fall then is there are lots of different conditions there that. For the standard, there are lots of variables in the standard then in terms of fall protection. Is your boy on the correct use end of the fall arrest system, the correct wearing of the harness, the correct length of the lanyards? We specifically investigated a couple of fatalities in terms of wrong lanyard length. You know, if you're subject to a 12-foot fall and you've got an 8-foot lanyard and you're 6 foot and, you know, they're sagging it, you're going to hit the ground. And that runs into an issue. We had one this year. So if the lanyard's too long, it's not going to protect you. Excavations in training. Competent person finds the evidence and training for that competent person and training that he has the authority then to remove other employees from the hazard, the authority to make sure the hazard gets corrected. So that competent person, when that competent person is identified, he's got quite a few responsibilities. He or she has a lot of responsibility, and so training on that person to verify that they are truly competent and capable of doing all the things that they're required. So there is training with excavations as well. Cranes and derricks provide training on the overhead power lines, the signaling persons, the operators, the competent persons and qualified persons in terms of rigging and inspections. All of the new crane standard then has detailed information on who has to be trained to what level depending on what their job or job task is. So, and again, not just the operator, but signaling persons, riggers, inspectors, all those things have specific training requirements for cranes and derricks.
New as of 12?
Yes. New as of 2012. Now the operator is extended again to, I don't know, is it October 14? Yeah. Eventually there will be a national certification for the operators, but that has been extended again now.
That's because of all the accidents.
Right. Exactly. Yeah. And not to say it's legit or not legit, a lot of them that we've investigated have actually been operator error. You know, not aware of their load limitations, not aware of the of the setup that was actually on the crane and know that its capacity changes depending on the setup and those things. Overriding safety switches. Yeah. So, and that's why specific training for those. Evaluate each employee required to be trained. Refresher training on relevant topics for each employee based on conduct. If you observe, you know, an issue, and that's like back to those near miss items. If you don't investigate those near misses and realize where the problems are, and then adjust your training and do some retraining based on that. Okay. Specific training for ladders. Provide training program for each employee using a ladder or stairway as necessary. Enable each employee to recognize the hazards. So, you know, as simple as ladders are, there is a specific training requirement for it. You can't just turn them loose. Okay. Asbestos. Highway road construction. I don't know if you may ever come across asbestos or not. I know you do lead. I don't know that you'd ever come across asbestos. But there is a requirement in the asbestos standard then for training and recognition.
We have that right away.
Do you have some right away issues?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. Where is it showing up in the right away? Is it on? Oh, okay. Okay, I hadn't thought of that. Okay, yeah. So especially like in Tulsa where they just, what?
Yeah,
demoed. Yeah, quite a bit. Okay. Yeah. Training of the asbestos abatement workers, which is usually going to be a subcontractor then who has to be certified and registered with the state of Oklahoma to do asbestos abatement. And so that's, if you're hiring someone that is certified and registered with the state, then you would, that would imply then that they're have taken care of their training and you've done your diligence. If you're hiring someone who's not, then it's on you to verify that that's been done and to have not hired a person who wasn't qualified and appropriate as far as the state goes. There are authorized trainers for the 10 and 30 hour, okay? 5 years experience in construction, 2 years of college, and these are some of the things that for the 10-hour course and the 30-hour course, some of the requirements, and people like the Votex coordinate some things like that. There are several different groups out there that provide the 10-hour and 30-hour classes. OSHA themselves, and we get this call a lot, we do not. OSHA, Federal OSHA, does not provide this training. It's always through a third party, a source of some sort, to provide the 10- and 30-hour courses.
The change here in the last couple years is they changed the maximum number of hours that they could teach in a day. Used to, you could go one day and take your 10-hour, and now it's 7.5 hours.
7.5 hours is the maximum.
So you have to split the 10-hour up into 2 days. Unless you get a waiver, there's a couple of organizations that have gotten waivers for doing a full 10-hour into 1 day. But.
And that, they set that up so you go from room to room and train 300 or 400 people at a time. It's special circumstances for those waivers.
The use of 10-hour versus 30-hour training come into play. In what instances would you need a 30-hour instead of a 10-hour?
If 10-hour is kind of a overall goes over our standards that apply to your industry, you can pick the 10.
Oh,
you know,
okay.
So if you're in Rose Bridge, you will tell the instructor,
okay.
Right.
These are the topics we want to cover. 30 hours of training the trainer, and it'll give you a card where you can go out and train people and actually issue certificates yourself.
But that was back to it, though. The 10-hour course doesn't necessarily qualify when we have a specific training requirement in a standard. That 10-hour course may or may not, you know, depending on the detail that's required by that standard. You know, yeah, like.
So if you know another company say, hey, we're having somebody come in and do an OSHA 10-hour for us. You want to make sure that it could be an electrical contractor.
Right.
They may not be covering the topics you need.
Yeah.
Okay. So. Customize these things. Yeah.
And that's the 510 is the, is that the 10 hour? Which one is? I can't even remember which number is, which one is.
Probably the 30.
You think it's a 30?
Yeah, it's
a 30. Okay.
Yeah,
so maybe that's a typo.
Oh,
but. Okay, 500 and 501 then? Okay.
Numbers aren't important.
Yeah. It's a 10-hour and 30-hour course. So, and then here, I think 502 then is the update, is the refresher. And it's a refresher, train the trainer.
If you've got your certificate to train, you have to refresh it.
Okay. Every 4 years, yeah. So. And here's the 7.5 hour. I forgot that was in there. So it is limited to 7.5 hour per day. There have been a couple of places that do apply for an exemption and get it to try and do, you know, a huge amount of people on a Saturday or something.
Is that just for the 30
hour? Just for the 10 hour.
Okay.
Right. No, I'm sorry. No, the every 4 years is the train the trainer. Okay. Is the 30 hour.
10 hour, is that good for?
Just however long, yeah. It's just okay. Yeah. Yeah.
That actually was going to be one of my questions. Like on the different training required in some of these.
All the different, right.
There's a few that you show that specifically say refreshed annually or annual retraining required.
Right.
If it does not designate retraining other than if you see someone not following through.
Right.
If it doesn't designate, once is enough.
Once is enough.
For
that's
example,
right.
A ladder.
Exactly.
I've got documentation.
I trained him 9 years ago on ladders, then exactly.
Okay.
Yeah. So, and what tends to happen, though, is you know, between employee turnover and just like that, you've observed some issues or... It goes back to the safety program and the documentation for if you want to argue the idea of the employee misconduct, then training that's a little more recent would go towards that. You go, well, I trained them 15 years ago. Well, you know, 15 years ago versus I just trained them 6 months ago, you know, is goes towards that component of that employee misconduct if that's, you know, becomes an issue. So. And I think that was it. That was, we, like I said, tried to go through, and if there is a resource, then all of the 1926 standards that had a training clause in them. So, and I hope we didn't miss any. The idea, though, and one something we wanted to mention was the difference between competent and qualified. And I'll try to explain it and give me some help here because it you... The qualified first, qualified simply mean is they've had the training, they've had the classes, they've had the classroom time, they are qualified, especially in terms of things like electrical. They have the specific knowledge so that you know they are able to do whatever it is you're asking them to do in a safe manner. The competent person then is a combination of training, time on the job, work experience, and you have identified this is my competent person. This is who I am relying on to take care of this situation. And I'm verifying, you as the employer are verifying that they are competent based on all that experience, a combination of experience and training, a combination of observations while you've been out there, and you're relying on that person, especially in terms of, say, trenching. Here's my competent person. I'm relying on him or her to evaluate this daily, hourly, as it changes, and make decisions and make adjustments and correct the hazard as things come up. Same for scaffold. Is he qualified? Has he had the training to erect the scaffold and put it together correctly? Versus is it my competent person on site who I'm relying on to fix it if it's wrong, to get people off of it if it's wrong? That makes sense? Is that...
So competent is the higher standard and requires a designation.
And that's a big deal. The competent requires a designation by you, the employer. This is my identified person. So, qualified, they may be qualified, but you didn't deem them to be the competent person. They're qualified because they've had all this training, but that's not your competent person on site. Is that close to being accurate?
Sure. I always think... Competency is not a certification. Competency is demonstrated.
Right.
So when you figure out who your common person is, they should be able to demonstrate to you that they know what they're doing out there, they know how to identify, and they've got the authority to take action.
And that's the authority to take action. And in fact, most of the standards call for a competent person. There's only a couple of them that call for a qualified. the electrical and the scaffold building is qualified, but a lot of them call for a competent person because that's who you've identified to take action.
So my driver's license, they qualify me to drive, but...
But you might not be competent. There you go.
Great example. I saw a lady this morning who was qualified to drive, but she was not competent.
Was not, there you go. Yeah, so, okay. Any other questions? Yes, that's if we went back to one, there was one, was it 35, that just referenced 1910, 1200. And so that's the 1200 then is all the hazardous materials, the HAZCOM programs.
So if you sat through 10 hours of training, then you would be certified?
No. No. Probably not.
No.
Okay.
They're not going to cover HAZCOM.
They're not going to cover HAZCOM to the detail that it needs covered.
Employers might have to do their own.
Right.
Are you talking HAZWOPER?
Yeah.
Oh, well, HAZWOPER's not either. I mean, HAZWOPER is its... Above and beyond, right.
Well, 40, 24, and then 800 refresh.
Yeah, so.
Depends on whether you're a technician.
Yeah.
Right, depending on what your scope is.
Storage and delivery, you got that 40, I think. No, not necessarily.
Yeah, we have the asphalt people. They're not great people. Now they have to go through some of that.
So, but even if it's not the HAZWOPER, just the HAZCOM training, you know, the 10-hour doesn't really qualify as HAZCOM training either, because when in that HAZCOM standard, there are several specific line items that say they have to be trained in these items. And you have to verify that was actually done and to what level that was done. So.
There are certain people exempt from keeping OSHA 300 logs. And if you have had 10 or less at any one time, every day of the previous calendar year, you do not have to keep OSHA 300 logs the next year. But if any time you hit 11 for one day, you have to keep the logs. Now, if you have less than 10 and you get a letter from the Bureau of Labor Statistics or OSHA to say, we need you to keep OSHA 300 logs, please keep them or they will send me out there.
Less than 10 instances?
Less than 10 employees. 10 employees at all times during the previous calendar year. Yeah. Employees. And if you're an industry of low hazard, which none of you in here are, such as retail, service, finance, insurance, those people do not have to keep logs. They don't get injuries. We don't go visit them that much, unless, of course, asked by BLS or OSHA. Almost fast. What does OSHA do with this data? OSHA itself develops those programs that David and Megan and Stephen have been talking about. It measures their own performance, and myself as an inspector will look at, the first thing I do is we'll ask for your OSHA 300 logs, and I'll look at those logs, and that tells me where to go and direct my efforts. I don't need to be going to office spaces. If I see people getting crushed fingers and amputated fingers, I'm going into the look at the machines that are causing those. I don't need to go waste my time in places that's not happening. The employer uses them to develop their safety and health programs, to identify the trends like David was talking about, and to resolve problems. I recently just did an investigation at a paramedics facility, EMSA, and of course they have sprains, strains, ergonomic injuries, lifting people, lifting stretchers, lifting their equipment, but they've identified that and have put in quite a large amount of money getting better stretchers, actually going out and looking at trucks that will, because currently now they have to push the patients in on the stretchers, that will grab the stretcher and pull it in itself. So they're in air mattresses that'll float patients. You know, society today is getting bigger and heavier, and so that's causing an additional strain on these guys, is just putting the patients on the stretchers. So that's what they did. They have identified from their OSHA 300 logs these trends and have developed safe work practices, bought better machinery, and they're funded for that, which is really good. A lot of people aren't. So that's what they do that with that. As David said, we take that data off those OSHA 300 logs. The national office looks at that. Where are our fatalities happening? Where are our injuries happening? And develop regional emphasis programs, those that apply to what you do is construction, cranes in construction, demolition, work zone safety. We go by and we see an issue with those, we're going to stop and do an inspection because that's where the accidents and injuries are happening. OSHA record keeping forms, you can get all of these on our website, www.osha.gov. The first one is the OSHA 300 log. That's where you actually record the date of the injury, the person who was injured, where they were injured, and left finger cut using saw, and whether they were killed, days away, lost time, and what type of injury it was. You need to do that within 7 days of being notified when that injury occurred. Please don't wait till the end of the year and then put them all on a log. The OSHA 301 is a supplemental record for each injury that you have on the log, and it's filled out in greater detail. I'll have an example of that up there. It has employee's name, his address, how long he's worked there, was he hospitalized, what occurred, how it occurred, what was a contributing factor, was it a piece of machinery, was he hit by a truck or cut by a saw, things like that. Gives us a little bit more information than just that one liner on the 300. Again, you're required to fill one of those out for each recordable injury on your log. OSHA 300A, that is the summary sheet of everything on the OSHA 300, it's just the total lines at the bottom. Those are put on the OSHA 300A. You also will put your average man hours for the year and total number of employees. Now with the man hours, average man hours, what I see a lot is they don't count the temps and they don't count the salaries. The more hours you work, the lower your rate is, so put everybody in there. It also has to be signed by the highest ranking individual in your facility, not the secretary or admin, head of admin. The president, the owner, needs to see this and sign it, okay? Here's your OSHA 300 log. Again, give it a unique number, person's name, their job title, the date of the event. You have one for each year, where it occurred, cut thumb while using box cutter. I see a lot of just cut thumb, back strain. It doesn't tell me anything. Then I have to start asking you the questions, look at your 301s. This really helps. Otherwise, we spend a lot more time looking at these, and it's quicker for us to look at these, find out where we're going, if you can give us enough description in that one line. A lot of these are computer generated now, and they'll give you a really big box to put all that information and then truncate it when it prints, so watch out for that. Here's your 301, the name, date of birth, whether he was hospitalized, where he was treated, and again, like I said, what occurred, how it occurred, what contributing factors were there. And a copy of the 300A, it's where you total everything off there, off your 300, name, average number of employees, total work hours. That's how we'll calculate your DART rate, your injury and illness rate. See if you're above the industry average, below the industry average, and that's where they sign. Again, can download any of these off the internet. For retention periods, you must keep 5 years worth of OSHA logs for our viewing pleasure when we come on site or if anybody asks for them. And of course, to date of the current year. And we do ask for them to look at them, and we all need copies of them to take away with us to put in the computer. You must post your OSHA 300A the following calendar year. So if it's 212, you will post it February of 2013, February 1, through the end of April. And you can post it on the employee bulletin board or where everybody can see it, basically, next to the time clock, whatever. But it must be posted for that amount of time, but signed copy.
Is this every year?
Or? Yes, every year. The 300A needs to be posted. You betcha. Yes, and they're going to be salaried. You can do a calculation on that, or even if, and don't forget overtime hours. Y'all work a lot of overtime. That helps bring your rates down. But it's just an honest way. That's what we want you to record for man hours, temp, overtime, and salaried.
And you're talking about exemption.
Mm-hmm. The less than 10.
Less than 10.
Less than 10.
You're counting owners or not?
Okay. You count your office staff and yes. Yeah. In the construction industry, If you have a project that's going to last over a year, you need to keep a separate OSHA 300 log for that site till it's over, and then combine all your other work sites into one. If you don't have one that's going to take over a year, you can combine all your work sites, injuries, and illnesses into one OSHA 300 log. Yes.
We're in traffic safety. We don't actually stay on that job site for any period of time. Go set signs, go out and service the signs on a periodic basis.
But the contract lasts for over a year.
But the contract lasts for over a year.
I don't know. It's a good question. I would say no, because you're not there all the time.
Special. Are they there?
Do you have people there every day?
No.
Yeah. I wouldn't split hairs over that. If I'm doing an inspection, as long as you've got them on some log and try to just stick to what's reasonable, as long as they're there somewhere, I would say fine.
What was the question? We're on job sites that last longer than a year, but we don't actually have a yard. We are not there every day. We don't report to the site every day.
I have another question.
Yes.
We do more small jobs, like, Do they have to be posted at the job or
no?
Like our offices?
Where you get your paycheck.
Okay.
Perfect. Right. Yeah.
We do those electronically.
Yeah.
We send them out.
Do you have a meeting somewhere, a room, once a month, once a day? Just
we have
where they come and go?
Yeah. They're in our job. Well, we have a mobile job trailer.
Yeah. They can put copies. Yeah. I'm not going to touch on this too much. The only reason I had put this in, workers' comp versus OSHA, in about 95% of the cases, our rules are the same. What they say is work-related and what we say is work-related. It's about the other 5% where they say it's not work-related and we say it is. They're two separate systems. Just because workers' comp says it's not, but OSHA says it does, for record-keeping purposes, if OSHA says it is, put it on the log. If you have a question, call.
Key there is if you find out it's not compensable, don't assume that you just line through on your OSHA 300 log. Check first, look and see, or call us. It still may be recordable and need to stay on the log even though it's not compensable.
True. Definition of work-related. To be put on the log, it has to be work-related and recordable. Work-related means it was caused by, contributed by, or significantly aggravated by a pre-existing condition. Makes it work-related. There are some exemptions to work-related injuries in the workplace. If you're an employee present in the work environment as a member of the public, say you work at Walmart, on your off day you go to Walmart, you fall, you injure yourself, just because you're an employee, it's not recordable. You can sue them, but it's not recordable. You're not there actually working. So it's Walmart. Yeah. If the injury and illness involves signs or symptoms that surface at work but result solely from a non-work-related event or exposure, example would be like a diabetic event. It has nothing to do with work. Nothing at work caused it. Just because you were at work and had it doesn't mean it's recordable. Injury and illness that results from voluntary participation in a wellness program, flu shot, exercise class, racquetball. If you're on the softball team voluntarily and you hurt yourself sliding into third base, it's not recordable. If you do manage the gym of the company and you're teaching a self-defense class and get injured, yes, it is recordable because you're in the capacity of a worker. So something that is solely the result of an employee eating, drinking, or preparing food or drink for personal consumption. If you choke on your sandwich at lunch, it's not recordable. It's the gist of that. Or hurt yourself blow drying your hair. Doing personal tasks at the establishment outside your normal working hours. If you go and use all the hammers and saws to build your son a toy box and you hurt your hand and need stitches, it is not recordable or work-related. Personal grooming, self-medication, non-work-related work condition, it's not work-related. If you bring a medication from home and you have a negative response to it at work, it is not. That's what that means. It's not work-related. If it's caused by a motor vehicle accident, incurs on the company parking lot while the employee is commuting to and from work. Motor vehicle accident. If you're in the parking lot of your work, it's considered part of your establishment. If you're walking and slip on ice, yes. But if it's a motor vehicle accident while you're commuting to and from work, it is not. It gets a little convoluted there. If you go to work, get back in your car, and you're on a company errand, yes, it is.
But question. And you may have touched on it. I missed it. But
yes, the rate I'm going.
Say the instance of a heart attack on the job. Is that work related? Could it ever be construed to be work related?
Very. We get the calls. You have to call us.
You got
to report it. But
okay.
It's not recordable unless you can absolutely. Yeah.
Well, you can see the attorneys climbing on that one.
Sure, sir.
You say that motor vehicle accident, you know, occurring. Now, I know that there are some that job site, you know, change, you know, job site to job site, and they get paid for windshield time from the moment they leave, you know, transitioning to whichever job site they go to. Covered.
No, I don't think so, because that's just the way they're being treated. It's commuting to or from. Like, if you're going from one job site, I don't know, it's more of...
Are they on the clock?
Yeah.
On the
yeah. Okay.
It's in the scope of
yeah.
work.
Yeah, yeah, I agree. Yeah.
Yeah, you're in a company vehicle, but not getting paid for it.
Yeah, like
from
going to work.
If it's commuting
no.
to... If it's commuting to and from work, either from a temporary residence hotel
yeah.
or your home, that's commuting.
Yeah, the commuting.
But if you go from one job site, now I've got to go over here, that's a
yes,
of work.
That is correct.
Go to the
I agree.
Job site.
But if they're going
even
to the,
if they're in a company vehicle.
Yeah, if they're in one of our vehicles, let them take it home.
Okay. Yeah.
That's a perk. That is
a yeah, perk. It's irregardless, of, no, that's not a word, of the vehicle you're driving.
Okay.
Doesn't apply. You could drive a motorcycle. Or
you can do detours.
No.
If you take a detour,
yeah.
Is it up there?
No. Like my guy that went to the bar.
Even if you're in a company vehicle and you're going from job site A to job site B in the scope of work, you just had to go over to the parts store and pick something up for personal use. That's a detour.
It's not work related.
It's not work.
All right. The employee's on the way home from a job site, commuting, on the clock, has a stroke.
You can't, what do you mean, commuting home
that
on the clock?
Home
on the clock.
From a job site.
If that's commuting.
We're paying.
Still commuting.
Right. So it's commuting.
Yeah, see, that'd be like.
They are on the clock, though. We are paying them to come home.
Yeah. It's not really a commute.
Has a stroke.
Depends on what, probably not, like no, the heart attack.
That wouldn't be right.
Okay.
Yeah, it has to be work related. It has to meet the criteria of
so
work related.
Is it recordable or it is recordable?
It has to first be work related.
So how come the heart attack's
we said no.
Oh, I thought you said yes.
No, no.
Sorry, my bad.
No, okay. That's fine.
These people were talking about the company truck deal.
Mm-hmm.
What I pointed out is it might be a workers' comp thing, but it's
correct.
Not OSHA. I mean, I don't
yeah.
know those rules.
Yeah,
so.
That's one of those little,
yeah.
that would go over, the, right, workers' comp, whether or not he was working. Under, that's that 5% gray area. Yeah.
It's
another exemption is a result of the common flu or cold, whether you catch it at work or not. So. Mental illness is not work related unless you can get the employee to bring you the doctor's note that says it is. A legitimate doctor's note. Yeah. Just a couple scenarios. We can run through these real quick. If an employee reports to work, later he steps out for a smokes break, slips on the ice, and injures his back, is that work-related?
Do you get paid for the break? I mean, are you being paid for
their designated smoke break area?
It's on the premises.
Yes, it is.
It's on the premises.
Employee drives into the parking lot, exits his car, and proceeds across the parking lot to check in. Another employee gets out of his car and starts beating up on him. The first employee breaks an arm and receives medical treatment. Work-related.
He hadn't made it into work,
though. Yes. Parking lot, clocking in, clocking out is not an issue. He's in the company parking lot. He's going to work. He's in the company parking lot. He's outside his commute. He's stepped out of his car. He is now at work.
That is work-related?
That's it. Yes, it is. It's physical. It's workplace violence.
So if he's still in the car, it's not work-related. No, it's the parking lot that is.
The parking lot it is. That's correct. I know, the motor vehicle thing.
It's the commutation.
So if they would have ran into each other in their cars,
no.
It wouldn't have been work-related.
Right.
How about car versus pedestrian?
The pedestrian gets hurt, yes.
It is.
The
driver knows. Because it's not motor vehicle.
Right, he's not crashing into anything. An employee is temporarily staying in a hotel while working on a construction site. Trips on in the hall, going to his car to go to work. And he's on work restrictions for 2 days. Is it work related? Any stay in a hotel one day or more becomes your home away from home. It is not. He's in the hotel. Now, and the commuting rules apply. If he gets in his car on his way to the job site, no. But if he hurts himself in the hotel, it's his home away from home. It's just like you getting hurt in your own house.
Here you go, Walmart again.
I guess through the hotel. Your employee eating lunch in his car. He wipes his sleeve across his eye and the metal shavings he got while being inside working on his sleeve cuts his eye. He receives medical treatment. Is it work-related?
Where's the car? Is it
in
the
parking
lot? You drove to the city party, we did.
This is a tinker one.
I say yes.
He wouldn't have that metal on in
the Bingo. He wouldn't have the metal, it's a condition of work. The metal on the sleeve from what he was doing. This, and I ran this to the national office. It's a tinker one. The thing about tinker employees, they are not paid for their lunch. So I get a lot of what happens because they are not on the clock. If you're not being paid for lunch and something happens, usually it is not work-related. So you have to watch those. Those are kind of a case-by-case scenario. This one was. He's on his unpaid lunch, but...
This would be...
Yes, it is, because it's... So we have work-related. Second criteria for being on the log is recordable. Things that make it recordable, death, loss of consciousness, medical treatment beyond first aid, days away from work, job transfer or restriction, and a significant injury or illness. A worker hurts his back at work and decides to take the next day off on his own accord. Is it recordable? No, correct. You have to have either the employer put you off because they feel that you need that, or a qualified physician, PA, whoever they are today. Employee has an allergic reaction to a flu shot and receives a prescription. No. Correct? No. Employee chokes on his sandwich during lunch break. An employee has him stay off work one day. And I gave that one away too. Employee building a toy box for his son after work, fractures his finger with his hammer. No. General contractor hires temporary workers. Two of the temporary workers are injured while working. They receive injuries that are recordable on the OSHA 300 log, and they're under direct supervision of the general contractor.
Yes, because they're under direct supervision.
Absolutely. If they were under the direct supervision of the temporary agency on site, they would be put on the temporary agency's log, which would totally skew OSHA's. First aid versus medical treatment. Again, a recordability, it has to be medical treatment. There is a finite list of first aid issues, and it's on our website. The best criteria I can tell you, if it's not on that list, it's probably medical treatment. And another thing to gauge whether it is or isn't, is it have to be administered by somebody who has training, like intravenously has to be put by a nurse or an RN. Shots have to be given by somebody who has had a level of training. The visit to the physician solely for observation or counseling, first aid or medical treatment.
Solely for observation or counseling? No.
First aid. Observation. They're not doing anything.
Even if it's a physician?
That's correct. Our butterfly bandages, first aid or medical treatment? She's correct. Wound coverings are first aid, like Band-Aids, even butterfly bandages. Wound closures, sutures, staplers, and glue are medical treatment. I didn't know about the glue. Medical glue. Gave you that answer. Removing foreign material from your eye by tweezers or other instruments. Medical treatment or first aid? Medical treatment. If you swab it or flush it, no, it's not. A one-time dose of prescription medicine at the physician's. No, Janet, it didn't used to be. It is.
It is now?
Yeah. Yeah. Any type of prescription level dose, whether it be a one-time or multiple. Tetanus shot.
Okay, question, since that's changing.
She's not allowed to ask questions. What's up?
Fancy training in D.C., right?
About 14 years ago, yeah.
Like, what if the doctor says, because they probably have this question, go home and take two naproxen instead of the one, the actual dose, which is one.
If he tells you to take it up at prescription strength, it is recordable.
Okay.
Yes. And they do that all the time. Yeah, and there's a chart out there. You can Google it, and it'll tell you what prescription strength of all that stuff is.
So would we decide on tetanus?
No. Now, if a company says, because you may be exposed to something like smallpox or something, and makes you take it, yes.
But doesn't the medical professional have to give the tetanus shot?
Right, but it's for prevention as opposed to... Yeah, exactly. You don't have it yet.
Wait a minute. I'm confused.
Preventative.
Step on the nail and go get a tetanus shot regardless. It's still first aid.
Yes.
Okay.
It didn't used to be.
Does that apply to the, like, Hep B?
Hep B is recordable.
Okay.
Because you had actual exposure.
Yes.
Or potential exposure.
If the physician, we get this a lot, physician writes the prescription, but the employee does not fill it. Because they just don't like to take drugs. First aid or medical treatment?
Medical treatment.
It is true. It was serious enough for him to write a prescription, whether the employee chooses to take it or not. An eye patch. First aid.
Would that be the same scenario as if they want to give him a shot?
Yes. If he recommends it and they say no due to religious beliefs or whatever, it's medical treatment. Administration of oxygen while transporting employee to the hospital. Most times, I would say 99% of the time, because it's the caveat to there is if there's not a noticeable injury or illness and they're just giving them oxygen, then why would you be in an ambulance? If you have a recognizable injury or an illness and they're giving you oxygen, it's reportable.
But you probably wouldn't. Okay.
Our goal, and we'd rather see you over record than under record, and if you're doing the best you can,
you see the effort.
I mean, there.
Yeah.
I get phone calls all the time. Our office gets phone calls all the time. Each case is different. There's always something just a little bit different, like the guy wiping his mouth with the sleeve with metal. So. Use of a splint neck collar to transport an employee to the hospital. First aid. Physical therapy. That's correct. Drinking of fluids to relieve heat stress. First aid when you go to intravenous, then it is
Or if they've lost consciousness before they get
there. There you go. That's automatic. Sutures, you already know that. First medical treatment. X-rays, blood tests, administration of prescription meds for diagnostic purposes only. First aid. Yeah. If you do an X-ray and it comes back negative, just because he has the X-ray doesn't mean it's medical treatment. If it comes back negative, it's not recordable. Diagnostic and observation, those kind of things, not. First degree burn. Depends. It depends on the treatment. All three. Third degree, absolutely. First and second, it depends. They're not, just because they're burns just does not mean they're automatically recordable. Depends on the treatment they give them. But third degree, always. Fractured rib, broken toe, punctured eardrum. Those are what we call significant injuries. You can't treat them really, but they're significant injuries. So yes, stuff like that need to be on recorded. That was pretty good for me. There's your resources. The best one I use, turned off the screen, is the OSHA Record Keeping Handbook. It's out there. You just do find and you can find all sorts. There's letters of interpretation, frequently asked questions, all the stuff I just told you about is mostly out of that book.
And of course, there's a bulletin board poster, the 3165.
Oh, really? It's somewhere in our office, I'm sure. And if you have any questions, I've got some cards up here. Email me. I'm not in my office, hardly, thank goodness. And no offense. And there's no parking. And I don't check my phones that much, but I do get a lot of calls on record keeping. But anybody in the office can call, ask for the duty officer, and they can answer your calls. OSHA State Consultation has some very good people there that are very knowledgeable of record keeping. So same, another resource there.
She's the expert, though. I mean, you are. She's had the training and experience.
The process is a compliance officer will show up at your job site. They have an ID. They have credentials. If somebody, because believe it or not, there's people out there that want to impersonate OSHA. I don't know who would want to be an OSHA person. But they'll, selling products, selling safety programs, and they may tell you, but they're not. But our people will show their ID. So they'll have an OSHA ID. If they don't show it to you, you should ask for it. Well, we need to know about that. Yeah. I bet you can. And we've had them stolen, and people show up. So, you know, we call the FBI. They investigate impersonating. Yeah, so. But we will show up, and, you know, we can be there for a number of reasons. Complaints, accidents, fatalities. We can be there for an emphasis program that we've talked about today. And we conduct an inspection. We do an opening conference. And we do a walk around, and usually we will take photographs, interview employees, and document things. Then we'll have a closing conference at the end. Okay, if we find hazards that we can show a violation exists, in other words, we've got a hazard and we've got employees exposed, we can issue a citation on the enforcement side of our business. So. What can happen there is a citation with monetary penalties. We have different classifications of violations. Serious, other than serious, repeats, willfuls, failure to abate. So that's the classification. Probably 80% of what we issue in Oklahoma are serious violations. Okay. A serious violation is where if an accident did occur due to that hazardous condition that the compliance officer saw at your job site, serious physical harm or death could occur to the employee as a result of that. Serious physical harm encompasses a wide range of stuff. You know, broken fingers, concussions, cuts, sprained ankles, you know. So serious doesn't mean it's, and there are ranges of serious. So what we do when we apply the penalty is we're analyzing and assessing how serious is it. So we do a probability and a severity quotient. So in other words, we're looking at if something did happen, what's the most probable type of injury that would occur. If it's a sprained ankle versus death, the penalty, the probabilities or the severity is going to be lower, and then we look at probability. We're looking, you know, what's the likelihood? And we couple those two together and come up with a penalty. The max for serious is $7,000. Okay? The max for other than serious is the same, but usually other than serious don't carry penalties. It's a matter of getting something corrected. You have to correct all hazards that we observe. Repeats occur when you've been cited for the same or similar hazard in a 5-year period. Okay, so your OSHA history does make a difference. You want to keep it clean. Repeats can the penalties for repeats can be up to $70,000 for each repeat. So just had an informal conference yesterday with a company that had the same thing happen in a 5-year period. So the penalty, instead of being $3,000 to $4,000, it was $22,000. You know, so we do multipliers when we look at repeats. Yes.
Can you clarify? You said that for the maximum fine for serious injury is $7,000, yes. But then for other than serious injuries, it's also $7,000. But
it's normally it's usually zero. Usually we don't apply a penalty.
Not an injury.
But you do have to correct the condition.
Yes. And Stacy just pointed out, a lot of our posting, record keeping, and our reporting, they're all other than serious, but they carry mandatory penalties. So if you don't report a fatality, it's a mandatory $5,000 penalty. If we don't hear about the fatality, yes.
If you guys show up, are you just going to show up? Or are you going to send me a letter first? Or does it depend on the situation?
It's a good question.
Oh, no.
Did you show up?
I suspect I know the answer.
Now, we do have a complaint process. So we receive about 600 complaints in Oklahoma, or in our office, per year. Majority of those, probably 75 to 80% of those, we handle by phone and fax because they're either anonymous, they're an ex-employee, they're someone in the general public. If it's a signed complaint by a current employee, we go out and inspect that. But you're not going to get anything before we come because we're just going to knock on your door. If it's non-formal, ex-employee anonymous, we have a process where we call you, tell you that we received this complaint, here are the allegations of hazardous conditions. Once we talk, we're going to fax you a letter, and we give you 5 days to respond back. Now, if you ignore it, you can assume that we're going to be there, and you're going to be given notice because you got a letter and you didn't respond to it. So, but most companies, they respond, and we close most of those out once we get them. But other inspections, no. We're going to show up on site unannounced to see the conditions the way they are every day.
Is there a handbook or reference regarding the fines?
Yeah. On our website, there's our policy, our inspection. It's called the Field Operations Manual.
Or you look at employer responsibility.
Yeah, there's a pamphlet. Yeah, the pamphlet. There's an OSHA employer responsibility pamphlet on. Yeah. Yeah, there's a couple of. If you look at our website and poke around a little bit, you'll find all that. Yeah. So that's repeat. Willful is an intentional disregard for employee safety and health. So it's an extended level of knowledge. The employer knew that the employees were at risk, and they intentionally put them at risk. And it's really kind of a frame of mind, a state of mind, that they're intentionally disregarding safety and health for the employees. These are difficult to document. They're not issued very often. But it seems like every year we have one or two of those.
And usually we have a body.
And a lot of the fatality, yeah, they come from fatality files sometimes. But
is that a result from the repeats?
Well, I was going to say, where do we get that extensive knowledge? Where do you think?
So, you know, we get companies that have been cited for serious, repeat, and each time the same thing. They get more knowledge each time what they should be doing. And so if it's needed, we use the willful classification. The penalties, max penalties are the same as repeat. They're $70,000. But the connotation of having a willful versus a repeat is worse.
Can there be multiple levels?
Multiple levels or multiple willfuls? What do you?
Can it be a willful repeat?
No.
That's what I mean.
Can there be a category?
No. Okay. Now, there can be a other repeat. So in other words, we go in and we find the same thing again, but it's other than serious, but it's cited again. So it could be an other repeat instead of a serious repeat. So the penalties would be lower on an other repeat. But willful is willful, yeah.
The reason I asked, there's a company in my industry that is no longer in business, but I want to say their fine was 400, and OSHA fine was $400,000.
Okay, now, you see, like we cited BP after the explosion that killed 15 people down there for $82 million, $82.5 million. The way we get to that is, you know, you can have a willful for each standard cited. So if we have five violations in the trenching standard, one for no ladder, one for no protective system, one for spoil pile being close to the edge, you can have $7,000, $70,000. Then on these PSM inspections, like the BP case, you get egregious willful. An egregious willful is a flagrant disregard, and we start placing penalties for each employee exposed, or it can be for each instance of the violation. So if we have a row of power presses over here, machinery that's unguarded, and we find that it's willful and it's flagrant, we can put a separate $70,000 penalty on every machine, even though it's the same standard violated.
What's your largest violation this year?
Is it Winniewood? What was that? 383. We had the Winniewood refinery had an explosion and killed two employees working on a boiler, and we had actually two cases. They were doing a turnaround where all the contractors were there, so we coupled that with the accident. And I think we had $285,000 on that one, I think. So now, Stacy worked on one that's probably the largest penalty ever. It was the Cintas case in Tulsa. What was that, $3.2 million, where the guy got killed in the dryer. So it was...
That was egregious. We had a videotape of every incident that they did the same thing he did. So we went by incident.
We counted the number of... He got on a moving conveyor and got dumped into a dryer. And they had videotape of the wash alley, and we counted every instance where an employee got on the belt and was exposed. So there was a $70,000 penalty on every exposure. Yeah, so... But that's how we get to those large fines. If you see in the news that OSHA fines somebody millions of dollars, that's how they got there. So they're using the willful, egregious policy. So average penalty for a serious in Oklahoma, I think the last I saw was between $2,000 and $3,000. It's not the max seven.
Because there is a reduction for size.
Yes, reductions, yeah. Size, history, good faith. So, when I talked about your safety and health program, if you have one and you only have minor deficiencies, you're going to get some percentage off for having that program. That's why we look at your program on every inspection we do, because we're assessing, are we going to give you any penalty reduction? Maximum on that is 25?
Yeah,
yeah. Maximum is 25% off of whatever we calculate. History is 10%. And then
10% plus too, though.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, that's right. We changed that. Yeah. If you have history, you get an added 10% penalty. If you don't have any history, you get a reduction. Okay. Or you get nothing for nothing. And then size. Small employers get a larger reduction. So if you have 10 or fewer, 60%, and then it's scaled down in percentage from there up to about 250, and then above, if you have more than 250 employees, you get no reduction. So we calculate that severity and probability on a $7,000 penalty and apply all of those adjustment factors. And that's how we average $25,000 to $3,000 per in Oklahoma. So
you said it was over a 5-year period, right?
Yes. Used to be 3, and that got changed, yeah. In 2010.
Is there a record place where, I mean, I have been cited before and corrected those deficiencies and whatnot, but is there over a period of time a document or a place I can go or get a report?
Shows your history?
History.
Our website.
Like a lost claims. I can go on your website.
You can go to our website, go to data and statistics, and you can do an establishment search, type in the name of your company, and you'll get all the inspections and what was cited. Problem is ODOT can do that too. Well, and cities can do it,
yeah.
You know. But, you can also, for your industry, I use this to prepare for this. I go in there and you can search what's been cited in your SIC code, in your industry. So you can kind of look to see what's happening out there and what we're finding.
You'll find the top 4, right?
Yes, you will. Yeah. There's a lot of public knowledge and information out there. Yeah. You can search fatalities, Who's had fatalities? Other questions? All right. Well, thank you so much for coming today. I appreciate your interest. Thanks, ODOT, for inviting us today and giving us an audience.
And, really appreciate that.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
Okay. And if you guys ever have questions, call us. We're not going to run out.